Hello, and welcome to Shadow of the Broker 124, The Dead Oasis. So, why don't we start with character introductions. Go ahead and roll your destiny as well as we're working through this. Let's start with Zeebo.
Alright, I'm playing Zeebo the Hutt, a young Hutt. I mean, old by human standards, because Hutts live, like, forever. But he is a trader, entrepreneur. He's a real chatty guy, but recently he's gotten a little bit into the more combat side of the Rebellion and has undergone a series of cybernetics to make him kind of a mobile battle tank of sorts.
Okay. Matthew.
Follow that.
Yes, I am playing... I am Jack, playing Macron Duvel, a fallen noble from the Core Worlds who has a lot of family issues, chief among them being that his hallucination of his sister, who has fallen to the dark side, is weirding around in his head.
Creaking Oak.
Yes, okay, so Creaking Oak, once upon a time, lived in a fantasy world, not in a fantasy world anymore. Dealing with that, you know. And so right now he's just kind of going along with the flow of things, trying to keep busy, keep his mind off his friends and family far away.
Yeah. Okay. Aiden.
I am Dan, playing Aiden. He is a Corellian Fringer pilot who is very interested in seeing the downfall of the Empire and finding the douchebag that took his ship forever ago.
It's been a while. I don't know if you're ever going to find him.
We have a lead. Me and Zeebo just have to follow up on it at some point. kind of waiting for his obligation to trigger again before we start doing it.
Yeah. Well, we'll see. I don't think it'll be here, though.
No, probably not.
How's everyone doing? I'm David, and I'll be playing R2M5, and he's a prototype rebel astromech designed with versatility and espionage in mind.
And then we'll stop with Sophia.
Hello, I'm Jack. I am playing Sophia Correale. Like Creaking Oak, once upon a time, she lived in a fantasy world and found out she was descended from a god and their effective devil. Both together, and then was on a, well, much like the song by Styx, on a rocket ship, or on on their starship, well out in space, and so now has kind of been lumped in with the Broker's agents in the Rebellion, because she kind of has no idea what's going on.
Okay, so, everyone's rolled. Is the roller working for people?
Yeah, I just had to close it and pull it back up. It seemed like everybody... I don't know what was going on with me. It was just weird.
Sounds good. So, do we have all three duty, obligation, and morality?
Yes, we do.
Okay.
It's probably going to start being a more common occurrence.
Indeed. Okay, 80, 20, and 20, 38.
Okay, 80 hits R2's quest to find the creator.
Interesting.
Ah, yes. Okay.
So drop your strain threshold by 2. Everyone else, drop it by 1. You've 20. All got some sort of stress going on in your lives so that are... It's getting to you, whatever that is. I'm assuming Macron is dealing with his sister annoying him. Sophia and Creaking Oak have some pretty obvious stuff. Maybe Aiden is thinking about his ship and where it is. What do you think?
He has the ship back. He's just trying to find the guy that took it forever ago.
Oh, okay. So maybe it's I really want to get him.
Yeah, some of the parts in there are custom, and he doesn't have them back.
Okay, and Zeebo is not affected. Zeebo is
correct.
Not stressed at all.
He correct.
Got,
money really does buy happiness.
Yeah, he's thinking about his money. How great the casino is going. Life is great. Laid back, sipping his favorite fruity beverage, and just, I mean, as much as he can lay back and put his non-existent feet up. That's it.
What is this fruity beverage you speak of?
You'll try sometime. It'll change your life.
It probably has some sort of normally poisonous frog in it.
That's generally what Hutts eat and drink, yeah.
it's definitely a sometimes poisonous frog.
Duty goes over.
It's a low roll. I guess we just had a reset. So.
We just had a reset, yeah. So we're only at 8 right now. morality hits Creaking Oak. Or not hits, but is closest to Creaking Oak.
Oh, is it Oak or the... Where's Oak at? Is he below 50?
Yeah, he's below 50.
Okay.
46, I think.
Okay. What is Oak's morality?
Love and naivety. So he cares deeply for those around him, but he will sometimes become easily manipulated by those people.
Okay, so if anyone
it's an interesting like, combo.
Feels like manipulating Creaking Oak, you might as well go ahead.
I mean, at this point, he'll probably believe anything you throw at him. He's in space. He's not used to this.
As you guys are chilling out on the Eclipse, it's a new home for some. Some are more accustomed to it. It's been several weeks since Hoth, and only about a week since Sophia and Creaking Oak were recovered and brought aboard.
And some of our agents went missing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But there's a summons to the bridge that goes out. Sophia and Creaking Oak have had to learn what the bridge is, but Jokin made sure that every new person aboard had a good understanding of how his ship worked. That's something that he prides himself on, I'm certain, of.
Yeah, mostly for them, stuff not to touch and stuff that's okay to touch.
So, and also, we are different.
Not to touch most things. Anything that's a glowing and can be pressed in, generally not something you want to touch.
At least until they know what it actually is.
Yes.
Or you touch it to find out what it does. Yep. That's Sophia's motto. Figure it out on the fly.
And I feel like R2 has had a lot more fixing to do.
So, as a part of the summons, you are told on your comms or whatever sort of device. What do you think Sophia and Creaking Oak would have at this moment? Would they have accepted some sort of comm device, being told that the
magical talking rock?
Probably. She has. She does have a prosthetic sword hand. By the end of the R-pole, she will. Mm-hmm. That little interaction between her, Regash, and Arlo, she will have a prosthetic hand. So. I mean, she's already, like, amazed that, like, this entirely mechanical hand she can still feel. And since Oak had her stuff, she's wearing her bloody raiments, which includes a set of blood-red gloves, so she's wearing those, but that she can still kind of... She's still amazed that she has this metal hand that still responds to her, like, her thoughts and things. So, like, oh, hey, there's a little thing that lets me talk to people far away when they're not here. Like, sweet. This is awesome. This solves so many problems. I no longer have to start a fire and find a blanket to send smoke signals. this is great. Or fire, like train a pigeon or a raven or an owl or something. This is like the bee's knees to her.
Just wait till we get on the sun flare. Aiden will show her the cockpit.
Oh, all the buttons! You'll have so much fun.
He will also say not to touch the buttons.
Oh, you're not even gonna let her like fly it for a little bit.
In a nice open stretch of space.
Yeah, of course. I mean, like, you don't, like, when you don't take your 15-year-old out on, like, the frickin' highway or the freeways or something, you find a church parking lot.
So, you are told, that there is something on long-range scanners, a fairly large ship, about as large as the Eclipse, actually. It does seem to be moving, but doesn't have a hyperdrive signature.
Sophia raises her hand. She has several questions. One, what are scanners? Two, what's a hyperdrive?
Aiden will kind of turn to her and be like, I can answer these questions afterwards. Hold all questions to the end. We'll help out afterwards.
The central conceit is, Sophia, is that compared to our technology, this ship is very, very old.
Oh, okay.
Or not as advanced, probably.
She nods. Okay. All right. I'll hold my questions till the end.
So are we being sent to investigate this ship?
So, you have been summoned to the bridge. It looks like scans of the ship are underway at the moment. Jokin says that information is coming in. We can try to probe it as much as we can. So what questions do you have?
I guess, where does it seem to be coming from or heading to?
It's compared to the speed that we're capable of moving, it's really hardly moving at all.
It's just basically orbiting?
It's not orbiting. It definitely has a trajectory. It seems to be in between two solar systems.
Do we have an approximate region of space?
We are in wild space.
Okay.
I guess here's the big one. Here's the big one, life signs.
Well, they haven't scanned it yet, right? Or it's not done being scanned.
Yeah, the scan is going through, and actually, the comm officer who's responsible for these scans is saying, I'm not getting any sort of interference like you would normally get from shielding. I don't think there's any sort of modern shielding on this thing, but there's over 3,000 life signs aboard.
Can we get any kind of idea of the composition of the ship? Does it seem to be made of similar materials to what we use, or does it seem like odd in that way?
We should have visual here soon. And, of course, the ship gets pulled up in front of you. The officer says it appears to have been built out of an asteroid. Scans are indicating that the inside is actually hollow. There seems to be some sort of rotation in the inside.
That's one way to get artificial gravity if you don't have the tech for it. Just make it big enough.
Reminds me of the stories of the old Coruscant sleeper ships.
Yeah, I mean, the gravity wouldn't be coming from the size. It would just be the rotation of... It seems to be some sort of drum that's spinning.
These life signs, I'm assuming they're people, are they, like, moving about, or are they kind of sitting in the same spot?
Yeah, can we tell if they're active?
Yes, there seems to be movement within the ship.
Okay. Can we try to contact them on, you know, long-range comms yet?
Do they seem to have any communications that they can... respond so, on, for that matter?
You go in for a tight beam transmission, and then the comm officer just replies, I don't think they have any way to receive this. It looks like some of these devices might be shortwave radio bands. We're going to have to get closer.
Are there weapons detected?
Nothing.
Or anything we recognize as them?
Nothing that would be a threat to the Eclipse, certainly, not even to a smaller ship. I'd say a fighter could bring this thing down if need be.
Well, are there any... Well, before that, I'd like to know, just from an exterior shot of the vessel, do we know where the engines are? Because what I'm thinking is, even if the ship may not have anything that would pose a threat to the Eclipse, it could still just ram us.
It does appear to have engines, but they are cold. It looks like whatever path that it's on, it's on.
They only fire when they need to, huh?
Yeah, without shielding, I can go straight through this thing. It looks like some sort of fission reactor. It's cold. I'm not even detecting enough fissile material to actually get those engines running again.
So it might be dead in space.
Well...
It is moving, though.
I mean, like, it's a wonderful thing.
Yeah, it might not have the ability to change course.
That seems accurate.
Well, it's enough to stifle whatever I got.
Do we have an obvious means of boarding, potentially? And how big is this thing? How big are we talking here?
About the size of the Eclipse.
So,
are there life support systems working?
And there's movement, so...
I mean, but they could be...
Yes, sure.
Who knows? Like, are they just low on engine power, or are they low on all power?
Power.
Sophia knows exactly what he's talking about.
She has no idea what's going on. She is just as confused as Oak, but she's trying to keep up.
It's admirable that she's trying, but yes. I applaud her for that.
We don't usually have the ability to... Usually whenever we sense atmosphere, we are going just through the atmosphere, actually piercing in through the shell of an asteroid. We're not really able to get those kind of readings.
Well, we seem to have enough information to at least mount what we could assume is a rescue mission. Perhaps we should just attempt it.
Well, is there any place we'd be able to dock?
Yeah, that's kind of what Aiden was asking before,
yeah,
too.
There do seem to be what we would consider outside airlocks, or at least tunnels going to the surface of the rock. I assume that those what these structures would be used for.
Could we fit something like the sun flare in there, or do we have to?
It looks like you'd have to land and then open it. So, if you're thinking okay. about going out there, you're going to need some suits.
We can do that. My armor seals against vacuum, so I could go out and do whatever.
Yeah, even looks at his jacket. It's like this is not sealable.
And well, you know, I don't really have lungs.
Oak's gonna pipe in and be like, "Do you expect me to go into the space? The space. That's where you want to go is the space."
We may not have to. If we just want to get the door open for a better look inside, we can simply have Art to do that. We don't even need Zevo to put on his armor.
I imagine squeezing that slug into that tin can's gotta be a pain.
It does take a lot of butter.
I came
does
back.
Does Akron know this from personal experience?
I just know that every time he gets into the armor, we suddenly run low on that stock.
I just now imagining Zeba. Hey, Macron, come butt in the ass.
It's actually just a pre-battle snack, generally. I mean, just sticks of butter. full of nutrients.
He spreads tubs of margarine on the butter, and then...
Oh, dear. I'm sorry I put us on this tangent. Anyway,
Macron's
suggestion...
What is going on?
Doctor's suggestion is to just have R2 open the door and take a peek inside, maybe with his scanner.
Yeah, easy enough. I mean, that would be the easiest and best thing to do.
Well, that's assuming he can interface with whatever kind of tech they have on this thing.
Listen, I can interface with whatever.
Right,
it's either going to be finesse or a torch.
Well, I guess at the very least he can tell us what we need to do. If it's something that might require manual force here, R2 may not be the best choice for that.
Yeah. Now where's Rock when you need him?
Jokin chimes in and says, "Before we break into it, let's see if we can at least talk to them. Let's move us in."
Well, yeah, no, but these are all, like, obviously the ideas after the whole, "Hey, guys, can you open the door?"
Yeah. This is in case we can't actually start communications with them.
Well, granted, they may not know our language, so
yeah, that falls under the same category, I think.
These are all very valid concerns. And as you guys get into what would be considered go ahead.
Sophia has one kind of concern, or at least a question. Can we tell what is on the ship? Like, because if it's more of those weird scaly things, I don't want to go on there.
Even if we do run into Trandoshans, I seriously doubt it would be the kind that you ran into on that one.
That's what they're called, the
Trandoshans.
Trandoshans. Okay. Good. Now I know what I need to hunt down and kill.
Yes, and we're presumably so much more advanced than these people that they may be walking around with nothing more than sticks and rocks.
I would be impressed if we got into space on sticks and rocks.
Well,
you at least understand. They know that you at least believe they understand ballistics. So,
and rocketry.
Yeah, but as was reported, there doesn't seem to be anything that would be weapon. Nothing that can be weaponized on it. Even the drive and the engines appears cold, so that couldn't go into meltdown or anything.
Well, I feel like we're not going to get any more questions answered standing around here.
Are we in shortwave range yet?
So, you move into what would be considered short, and from the vision, you actually see a few lights at the top here start to turn on, and the comm officer actually starts to chuckle a bit. They're sending us a transmission through broadcast. That's pretty quaint. It appears to be some sort of data packet. I'm gonna need to have to run this through. It's a bit foreign. R2, can you give me a hand with this?
Yeah, let me have a crack at it. I'll make it go by faster.
Okay, yeah. So, R2, what you've got here is some pretty fundamental... It's fundamentally different than what you're accustomed to looking to. But go ahead and give me a hard computers check.
Alright, I'm guessing my typical gear is applied to it.
It's so. Not slicing, if it's specific to slicing. Code breaking, all of that would apply.
So, code breaking, that's not going to reduce the difficulty because it's only hard.
With the data breaker,
code breaker does reduce the difficulty by one.
Oh, it does reduce the difficulty? I thought it just downgraded it. No. Okay.
I feel like that comes up every time you use the code breaker.
It does every time, not going to lie. Alright, this should be enough.
Yep, that was
more
enough.
Than enough. What you see is a series of more complicated mathematics. They sort of build onto one another, and then you start to see components of language. It looks like what this transmission is a translation algorithm.
Oh, well then, maybe I should upload that into myself.
Go ahead and upload that into the system too, buddy.
Yeah, just like uploading it everywhere.
Yeah. And with that, you actually do begin get a transmission going, and there's a voice that comes across. As the routine algorithm starts to translate it, greetings. This is the Uvan. We are humbled to be the first of our people to confirm that the galaxy is not empty of intelligent life.
What?
This is a generation ship sent forth to find a habitable planet in the closest solar system to our home planet. Our resources, however, are below 3% of our capacity. Even with air, water, and biomass recyclers maintaining optimum output, we are not likely to make it to our destination. This is a plea. We understand any hesitancy to share more advanced technology, but we ask for whatever aid you're willing to provide.
Brandon, could you just type out the name of the species in there, just so I...
And the name of the ship.
Yeah. Okay.
Move on.
Not what Jack was thinking.
Oh, it's not what I was thinking. I just wanted to make absolutely sure.
Nah, let's go ahead and do it, because that's a great arc to live through.
I'm not sure what Vong is, so it must be from something I'm not familiar with. I'm going to assume Doctor Who?
No, that's the end of Star Wars.
It's the new Jedi Order series of books. It's like 24 books long or something.
They basically wipe out like half the galaxy, and they're very...
Yeah, they drop a moon on Chewbacca.
Oh, wow.
I mean, to be fair, that's what it took to take him out.
It's like outside the Force, so it's weird.
Outside the galaxy.
Yes. So anyway,
Zivo will reply and hit the button that automatically translates to Basic, because he doesn't speak Basic, and reply that, yeah, indeed, we are intelligent life. Perhaps one of our technicians could help restore some of the supplies in their reactor? Question mark.
And Aiden will also, you know, kind of chime in and say that. And if you have a way of to have us either dock with you or perhaps board on a smaller ship, we may be able to help with anything else you might need too.
Any assistance is appreciated. docking, I'm afraid that we lost our ability to hold smaller ships, but there are access ports. I assume you would have the ability to spacewalk?
Yeah, I don't see why not. Yeah.
Sophia goes, of course we can spacewalk.
Do you guys know that spell?
I don't know what it is, but I don't see why not.
That sounds fun.
I assume the Eclipse has a general supply of you know.
The sun flare does it in the very least.
Yes. You are on a spaceship. You're going to have access to things like that, so.
Or it could just be a droid, be superior to your organic needs.
This is very true.
Not all of us can be droid perfection. Like R2 and Rock.
So the voice over the line points to, gives a location of one of the tubes that you had identified earlier, and says that I'll have emissaries to meet you there. One thing to note is that they will not be in pressured clothing.
So is
lost the ability to use that equipment a while ago.
Like, so they have an airlock or something? Like, that's not Sophia asking, that's...
Yes. It appears to be the location of an airlock.
But cool. They'll be waiting in a safe spot so that when we come in, they're not just going to immediately depressurize, right?
Yes.
Okay. I just want to make sure these people aren't dumb.
I mean, relatively speaking, possibly, but on a broad brushstrokes level, probably not. All right. Do we need any more information before we go in?
I think we're good.
I think Zivo's ready.
Yeah, so
I don't think
ready
I should need any bombs. I think we're good.
Yeah, Zivo will grab a spare data pad so he can take notes on all this for the for everyone, the Rebellion, the Broker, Erdo, everyone who could be interested.
Erdo would be very interested.
Right, in what amounts to like an uncontacted tribe.
Sophia's happy to be involved.
They had to have gone a very specific path to avoid all other life in the galaxy.
Or just really slowly from wherever they started.
Yeah, remember they went
through the mass, like, they were slowly drifting through dead space, essentially. Like, no one has any reason to be there.
Right, like, think about, like, the Voyagers that are a couple billion miles away, fractions of a light year, and have been going for, like, 30 years.
Yeah, if they're going,
and they just left the solar system. Like, they haven't made it a fraction of the way anywhere else.
Yeah, they're not traveling at the same speeds the rest of the galaxy is, I suppose. Yeah. All right.
Cool. So let's put on our spacewalking shoes and go for a spacewalk.
Aiden will show Sophia and Oak what a spacesuit is. and how to not die while wearing it.
You might also want to explain the concept of a vacuum.
Yeah, so basically he'll just say, it's like, look, if you take this helmet off while we're not in a safe area, you will die. You will have no air.
Okay. That's all Sophia really needs to know. Don't touch the helmet.
Yeah. Keep everything on and attached while you're out there.
Okay. This Sophia can do. But she is curious about Oak, because he's larger than your average bear, so to speak.
Larger than life.
He is silhouette too, I believe.
Yeah,
I imagine a fair deal larger.
As a Rebellion ships, they have spacesuits for all types of species.
I just don't know any SIL-2 species.
Neither do I. I think even like Wookiees at their largest are like silhouette one still, or even like the Herglicks that Taylor used to play, they're still silhouette one, even though they're like the size of a barn.
Yeah, Oak's got to be at least like 10+ feet, right?
Yeah, I mean, he's
to be fair, speeders are silhouette too, and they vary a lot in size.
Yeah. No, obviously, but I assume he's at the, like, Zivo is at the very top end of Sil 1. I assume that he is at the very bottom of Sill 2.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's pretty big, but he doesn't incur penalties taking on Sill at one thing, so he's not like he's just monstrous compared to everyone
Sill
else.
Zero but... things though. That would be an issue. He cannot fight Chim Chim.
Yeah.
No, he should not fight Chim Chim.
But Oak's just gonna look at this suit and then you guys and he's gonna say, "Why can't I just hold my breath?"
You know, you do work so well.
The danger of space is more than the lack of air.
The vacuum will rip the air from your lungs and probably explode several of your major organs. And all he hears is beep, 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 beep.
I've never met a golem that only speaks in beeps.
I've fairly spoken common.
To speak in basic, or speak thieves can, at the very least.
Aiden will say, you know, it's pretty common with droids of his size.
Do you understand what he's saying? Is it a he?
You get used to it after a while.
Sophia will kind of like feel the outer shell of R2 because she's never seen like a golem made of metal, or like at least this colored metal or this kind of metal before. So it's like
tough.
Such an odd, tough little golem.
Yeah, he's got it where it counts.
Yeah.
But you understand what he's saying, right? Because I don't.
When you've been around them long enough, you do. Yeah, you pick
up on it. Pretend.
Okay. I can get every other word, and I just piece it together.
Because I don't understand what the large being says either. And she kind of gestures to Zeebo.
That is a whole another story.
At least he has a translator.
Oh, okay.
We'll get you some classes on Hatice at some point. It's pretty common in the galaxy, so.
Hatice?
That's the language he speaks.
Oh, okay. Okay. There's so much to learn. I'm excited, but like, I'm way in over my head.
Yes. Man, this makes me.
This is fun. You're all provided with earpieces they're keyed into the translation algorithm.
Very useful.
Excellent.
And Jokin notes that there has been a suit prepared for Creaking Oak once he was aboard. It was realized that they may not have had a suit prepared for something as large as that, but it has been prepared in the meantime.
Cool.
It's a one-size-fits-none suit. Very baggy.
One-size-fits-all,
it inflates to be just a big ball.
Right. The one-size-fits-many.
At the same time.
The idea is that it could also fit a hut, so...
So he's like in a giant hamster ball.
Yes.
That's amazing.
That's hilarious.
Okay, with little feet sticking out of the bottom.
Well, if all those fails, I guess we can hop into his suit on the way back.
Okay.
So, Aiden, you get the sunflare prepared, and... prepare to set off to make a good landing. It's going to be an average piloting check with two setbacks.
Okay, I remove those.
Yeah. So it is a little strange. Usually whenever you're docking, you try to, you know, end your momentum, but you're having to match that momentum and then land. So it's a little different than what you're used to, but it's not too bad.
I forget, does the sunflare have positive handling?
I think only when Jokin...
I think with Jokin gone, it no longer... I think it's back to neutral.
Okay.
That's better than negative.
It is. Yeah, it's zero. Okay. So
we go from the big ship to the small ship. And now we're going to go on to that big ship?
So Aiden, seeing that there are two newbies on board that are completely far into the idea of starships, is going to showboat, just for the heck of it.
Excellent. So Sophia's going to sit in the co-pilot seat, because she's kind of amazed at all the stars.
Yeah, watch. This will be interesting. And you might want to buckle up.
What's a buckle?
It's the Wait. Thing on the side there, yeah.
Okay.
Just
buckle herself in.
Yeah. So
interesting question. Can that translation algorithm translate anything other than the native language of Ubans?
No, it was it was specifically designed to provide a foreign intelligence a way to translate their own language.
It takes two strain and then uses second wind to get it back. And then, yep, I add a triumph to that. So he does some little loop-de-loops as he comes in for a landing and corkscrews. And
Sophia tightly grips the hand the handles as like the ship goes around, and she's there's an absolute look of utter terror on her
face. But due to the ship's inertial dampeners,
she doesn't feel the G-forces, but she still sees everything spinning out the viewfinder.
Exactly. And panics.
She doesn't pass out. Yeah. She's just like death gripped into the seat.
Something Aiden might have in the back of his head, thinking about the fact that he can do this on the sun flare, and obviously move quite a bit faster than this thing, is that there's no indication that this thing has inertial dampeners. That's fairly fairly advanced technology.
Interesting.
Yeah, we should be wary of the G-forces inside this ship if we ever get it moving again. They likely don't have anything to compensate for it.
Right, if they have to make gravity by spinning, that means they can't control gravity, which means they can't negate gravity.
Yeah. Is that more a message to yourself, not just showboat, if you try and fly this?
What was that?
To fly the asteroid.
Oh, yeah, if it ever comes to the point where you have to fly this, maybe you're just noting to yourself, all right, don't showboat with it.
Yes, that's the two advantage, yeah.
Sophia Warmark, I understood absolutely nothing from that exchange.
It's all right, you'll get there.
What does the enemy, the G-force, look like?
Zivo pushes down.
What is inertia?
Yeah, I mean, go ahead and roleplay this out, guys.
So,
Sophia will slowly look over at Aiden and politely ask him not to do that again.
He's like, it's all right. It was too good an opportunity to pass up.
That was a good opportunity.
When Oak asks what the G-force is, Zivo will reach over and push down on the top of his head and say, this is what the G-force feels like.
Can your tiny arms reach his head?
His shoulder, then. Or his elbow, I don't know.
Okay, yeah.
The small of his back.
Zivo's very tall, he's just not Oak tall, but you're right, he does have little T-Rex arms, so maybe just
you say, ah, yes, the element of Earth, yes, that's what we know about.
Basic come. Yeah. Alright, so Aiden kind of pulls us in for a landing, and like, what is the docking area, or whatever you want to call it, the airlock?
Actually landing on the surface.
Oh, so just on the surface of the asteroid,
yeah,
okay.
Based on what was said earlier, they may have had some docking, like, landing area at one point, but they don't anymore.
Yeah, so he gets into the closest reasonable terrain to where the airlock is, and finds a nice area so it won't be too hard of a walk or climb or whatever has to be done to get there.
Yeah, and you're able to find a really good spot. You know, this should be a cinch for someone who knows what they're doing in a spacesuit.
Yes. So, like, Sophia will, like, very, like, unbuckle herself and, like, very carefully take her hands off of the chair that she's probably, maybe not permanently indented, but, like, try to prize herself out of the chair. And like, she's going to wait till everyone else goes out. Hold on. She's feeling kind of bold. She'll go out second. She'll let Aiden go first, or someone else go first.
Oh yeah, Aiden would definitely lead the way, or at least show people that would want to lead the way to the front. You know, he'd make sure everyone's, you know, getting off the ship all right and all that, especially the newbies.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so yeah, he'd probably hang back then.
So everyone does fine with the walk if they've done it before. Can I get a hard coordination check from Sophia and Creaking Oak?
Okay.
Oh boy.
Yeah, those two might have issues.
Zivo's got his whip in his hand, ready to...
So Sophia's gonna kind of, like, as she, like, gets out onto the surface, she's gonna kind of, like, get on all fours and, like, try to, like, crawl very slowly across the surface of this asteroid.
I'm gonna upgrade both of your checks, by the way.
Alright.
Wouldn't they already have an upgrade just for being the primitive, or is that only for tech, specifically?
I think that's the interaction with...
With tech.
Technology.
Okay. Okay.
So all movement is difficult terrain as well, by the way.
So because... Sophia starts to float off as she desperately tries to, like, swipe and claw at the ground to stay attached, and she's freaking out.
Do we need a whip here?
can we say Aiden is there to kind of, like, pull them back? Because he would have been definitely watching out for this.
Yes, so if I can get, if both of you are looking out, Aiden, if you could give me a athletics check, it'll be hard as well as Sophia starts flailing about. But Zeebo can also do a melee check if he wants.
Yeah, Aiden is not athletic in that way, at least. He's fast, he's not strong. Mm-hmm.
Using the triumph for ensnare, presuming I need to ensnare.
Yeah.
Is Oak using those dark side for anything? Or
no, that was a mistake.
Okay.
So Oak immediately jumps off as well. It puts one foot down and then pushes off and starts moving.
Aiden will roll the athletics check, but I doubt he'll make it.
Don't worry, I got you, battle.
just in case, just so he has a fighting chance.
Okay.
That's so a result.
You don't manage to grab onto him, but...
Or maybe he does manage to grab onto him, but continues.
Now, could the triumph be that we had the foresight to tie a rope?
You can control the mag boots yourselves. Like, someone else can actually manipulate their suits.
So, like, a computer's check?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, for R2, presumably, not for you.
Yeah, okay. So he has remote control of the mag boots?
Yes.
I can remote...
Different.
Okay, I just don't know how mag boots work on rock, but okay, I'm not the scientist here.
R2 is a giant remote control.
Yeah, basically. I'm a universal remote. I just need to know the difficulty.
It's gonna be average.
Oh.
Sorry that you have an enormous, enormous pool to throw at that. So, Oak, you hear some noise coming from your feet, and then you slowly begin to descend back to the surface of the asteroid. And once you're at the surface, you realize that your feet are starting to move on their own.
I would have just sort of, R2 might just like whirl his head around and kind of annoyed beep and just be like, why didn't you just do that to begin with?
Oak's gonna turn to everyone else and he's gonna say, the people from the ship have ensorcelled my shoes. There's something.
I mean, calm down, Oak. That's how these things work.
What witchcraft is this? Sophia will literally yell, what witchcraft is this?
This is going to be a long...
a fair warning. If Aiden grabbed her, Sophia's going to have like a death grip on your arm or something while we're outside for the moment.
Yeah, he attempted to grab Oak and that didn't go so well, but I'll say
he's the one who got Sophia.
Yeah.
Oh, Zeebo got some. Okay.
With the whip, yeah.
With the whip.
Yep.
So she's going to hang tightly to that whip and look at Zeebo very, like, very trustingly. Like, please don't let me go.
Oh, man, this is the perfect mission to have these guys on. I mean,
this is. This is going to be an absolute treat. Because we're going to meet people who are far more advanced than us. But then we're... Like, and but are amazed that we're somehow in the freaking galaxy.
It is going to be interesting to see you have a sword. I'm going to say that, so...
Zeebo will gesture towards their air tanks and that we're burning up our, you know, limited amount of air.
Oh, right, you guys, organics have to breathe, I forgot about that.
Sophia will yell, these things don't have a lot of air in them?
I mean, well, they
you
have
guys,
a lot,
I don't know.
But you
Zeebo
want...
only has 10. Zeebo only gets 10 minutes in his armor.
So we should move. That might have been a fact Zeebo should have mentioned before he left in just the armor.
We weren't going very far before we started, you know, dicking around with floating.
Hey, I'm not dicking around. I've never been in zero gravity before.
Okay, so the airlock opens at the at a touch. You can sort of, you can't hear it because you're in space, but you know it's sort of like struggling to open, and then you, it closes behind you. Everything lights up. There's a lock behind you, and then everyone sort of recognizes the signs that it's cycling.
Let's just hope they're an oxygen-based species.
Except except Sophia and Oak, we have no idea what's going on.
It's true.
R2, are you able to scan the quality of the air to see if it's breathable?
I can most scan.
So R2 does recognize that the what is being pumped in at the moment is breathable air.
Good.
But then there's a sudden shudder, and the lights cut out.
Oh, it's good.
A red backup light comes on. And it seems to indicate some sort of malfunction.
Wonderful.
R2, I think this is your
air
time to shine.
No, not at the moment. There's not enough air.
So is the outer door still open?
The outer door had sealed shut.
What about the inner door?
It is, of course, sealed shut as well, because it's an airlock.
Is there any sort of interface or panel or anything?
Yes, you see... You recognize around you that you can break a panel open and maybe diagnose what's going wrong with this thing.
All right. Is it at my level?
Do we have to force the panel off first, or is it like just something that R2 can just access?
Yeah, R2 is able, with his assortment of tools, able to not only detect where the panel to open would be, he can get it open himself.
I seriously have not met a piece of metal I can't cut in half.
Well, you've met Rock.
I can cut you in half.
Him. Rock isn't here.
Yeah. Rock has kurtosis, remember, so...
Yep. Rock is very difficult to cut in half. In fact, unless you're using, I believe, planetary scale damage, you're going to have a... Or your chim-chim. You're going to be hell-pressed to hurt Rock.
All right, anyway, yeah, do you want to just make a mechanics check on this thing?
So, looking at the age of the machinery, not only is it old, it's, you know, really old technology compared to what you're used to as well, but it's not well maintained.
Fantastic, that's the best kind of tech.
So, it's going to be daunting with 3 setbacks.
Okay, so 4 purple and 1 setback, because I'm awesome.
Because you're a gearhead?
Yeah.
Zico will give you unskilled assistance, shining one of his built-in lights or something.
I mean, R2 has those too, is the problem. That's the way I was going to have Aiden do it, but...
Okay, yeah, whatever, it works.
Yeah, get the assistance.
It should be easy enough. Did I do it? Did I roll it? I did. Okay.
Yes. Yep. Okay. So, yes, you're able to work on it a bit. You see that it's really just from age. This thing just... You're not even sure of how often it's been used, if it's been used at all, you know, in the last 100 years.
Yeah.
It's, so you get it going, and then, you know, the power jumps on again, and it begins to recycle. And everything seems to be going okay. You have 5 advantage.
Sweet.
Anything in particular you're interested from that?
maybe to just start getting an idea of where they are technologically speaking. So that way I can maybe start getting an idea of just how to interface with it more effectively.
Yeah, and it's not likely this would be networked with the rest of the ship, right?
No.
Yeah.
There's no network here.
Yeah.
That you can see that's connected to this airlock. It looks like there's no remote. Nothing remotely can trigger this airlock.
Yeah, I'm not worried about that. I'm assuming their computer systems aren't even advanced enough to accomplish large-scale networking.
Yeah.
They're still running Windows ME.
Yeah, I'll just, for the advantage, I'll emphasize again. You're curious as to why, I mean, if they've got this kind of technology... Why wasn't it maintained, at the very least?
I have my own theories already, but I will continue on until I've confirmed or denied this. Disproven.
Space Buccaneers!
Okay, so it cycles and opens, and you see two figures before you. They are humanoid, green skin. It appears to be skin, not scales or anything. It looks like they've got some facial ridges. Not ringing any bells on species you've seen before. It does look like these things are not something the galaxy has seen before.
So not even a xenology check or anything.
Golem or little folk. Gotcha. Sophia keeps her helmet on and the suit sealed.
Good call, for now at least. Although, actually, no. Aiden was like, you know, it's actually breathable here. You should be okay taking the helmet off. Save the air in there in case we need it later.
Are you sure?
I mean, if you want to get the risk not having air out there, go for it.
Like, just okay.
Random beeps.
There's only so much air in those tanks. Better to breathe the air you have now while you have it.
Okay. Does Aiden take his helmet off?
Yes. Okay. He'll take his off and demonstrate that it's okay.
All right. Then Sophia will take hers off.
Yeah, Ziva will start recharging his air.
But Ziva is still in his, like, tank armor, right?
Yeah, he's still in the armor. He's just, I don't know, popped the little head hatch open or something.
Yeah, he's in conversation mode.
Okay. So they nod and they do a sort of, like, gentle bow. You get the sense that that's probably their gesture.
Sophia will bow in return.
And then they reach an arm out. Can I get a 1d100 from Sophia, Aiden, and Macron and Oak? You see that their eyes sort of dart to Ziva when his thing just goes open. They're not really sure what he is.
Screw us, spacers.
Yeah.
Missing one d100 still, I think.
Yes. Jack, are you here?
Oh, he did say BRB, but I thought that was a while ago.
Yeah.
I thought he came back.
Away from the computer.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah, a D100 as they are introducing themselves to everyone. Okay. So, Sophia, as this introduction is happening, you feel something left in your hand. Can I get a perception check from everyone else? It's three red and a purple.
Yes.
Just of those or everyone else? Everyone else.
Everyone else can.
Okay, I'm gonna flip and take a strain for intense focus. Yeah, to upgrade it.
Can I get a general sense of the size, shape, and weight of whatever was left in my hand?
It feels like a piece of parchment.
Okay. She'll keep her fist. She'll keep her hand closed for the moment.
How quaint. Not.
Why are you looking at the ladies, Macron?
You guys all get...
Oh, wow. Bears abound.
All okay. Sorts of different things.
Yeah, so... both parchment. R2 I'll and Zivo that. Notice there's something that remained in Sophia's hand. You're both very suspicious of her because of this. Not only is she new to the crew...
Now she's receiving secret handoffs from alien species.
Exactly.
Parchment of all things.
Well, I mean, does Sophia divulge what this is?
She looks like a little confused when she feels it passed into her hand. And she'll send kind of so which of the two actually hands it off to her?
There's one that's male looking and one that's female, and it's the male.
It's the male. Okay. So she'll give kind of a quizzical look at him, and then, like, kind of look down at, like, kind of glance down at her hand, and, like, start to say something, like, what is this?
You hear him start to talk over you as soon as you say anything. The administrator is looking forward to meeting you. We are to guide you into the biocylinder.
Oh.
You see him... just smiling at you.
we can reasonably infer, those of us who are spacefaring regular folk, that the bio's cylinder is the asteroid bolted onto the back that spins and gives gravity?
Yes. From the scans, there's actually appears to be a drum inside that is spinning. So
oh, wait a minute. So where we are right now currently has no gravity.
Yes, this is true.
That so we still have the magnets.
It's going to be like that Gundam wing floating through the hallways thing.
or we just have the magnets on still.
That's no fun.
All right. So Sophia's going to kind of hang to the back. And since, well, she kind of knows Aiden the most at the moment.
Good luck reading it.
Aside from Creaking Oak, she's going to kind of like pull on Aiden to kind of like hang towards the back.
He'll follow suit.
And she's going to...
Before we move forward there, okay. Macron and Aiden both had their attention on the woman. For some reason, you're finding this species very attractive.
Oh my.
Interesting?
What's to say Sophia doesn't find the species attractive as well? I'm just kidding.
And then Oak, you have a triumph from your failed perception. So you don't notice what's going on with Sophia, but you may notice something else. Any ideas?
Is there any kind of body language I can read off them?
Like, or maybe you could tell that we're...
You don't catch the handoff of the note, but you do notice the man interrupting Sophia as she begins to talk, and you realize that there was a bead of sweat going down his face as he did so.
Okay, cool.
Or, well, you're not in gravity, so it's like dripping away from his face. Sure, you thought that was kind of weird, but then you realize that the element of Earth isn't here. And
so that's the threat, is that he actually is more fascinated by the floating
globule of sweat
than anything else.
It's dancing in the zero Gs.
I mean, it sticks a bit, but then it can float away.
All right, so Aiden will hang back a little bit at Sophia's insistence.
And Sophia will kind of, like, looking around a bit, like, not sure, kind of open, like, cupping her hands, like, kind of opening up and with this parchment and, like, unraveling it a bit.
Good luck reading it.
Yeah, does it look like anything we can read?
It does look like some sort of script, but you definitely can't read it. You realize that the translation algorithm, there wasn't anything provided that had letters necessarily.
It didn't have anything to do with writing, yeah.
Okay. So
Aiden will just pass this to R2. He might be able to do something with it, but other than that, I don't know.
Who is R2?
He'll point at R2.
The golem. Okay.
The tiny golem. Kind
of, she'll walk up and she's not sure where to tap him, so she just kind of taps R2 at the top of his head. kind of politely and, as politely as she can.
Well, also discreetly, I assume.
Yes, somewhat discreetly.
Like, you'd see a little cam eye turn around and look right at you.
R2? Can you read this? And she'll kind of like hold it in front of your cam lens, probably far too close for you to be able to focus.
I would probably just zoom the cam lens back a little bit, and then I guess, can I use the translation algorithm in my head to use any of the letters, or can I work something?
You really need an example of the actual writing.
Are there any examples around?
But at least he'd have this kind of recorded for now, at the very least.
You don't see anything, like, even any, like, diagrams or anything. That would
not even, like, emergency exit or anything? Or, like, don't open door if there isn't air, or...
there is an
keep off the grass?
Above the airlock that you can infer probably means airlock, and you start to get a sense of it, but you really need more examples.
I will keep my eyes open for examples of writing, and then try to translate paper as I go along.
Actually, can I roll a skill degree check just to make sure that she's doing this kind of stealthily?
Oh, the handoff? Yeah, choose your
own. So not the handoff, but like the whole, like, the stuff of showing it to Aiden and showing it to R2.
doing a skullduggery check to make sure that Sophia doesn't mess up.
Yeah. Yeah.
And make it super, super obvious.
Yes.
R2, read this!
So I'm going to go average because she only has two green in skullduggery. But she's going to try.
I'm going to go ahead and flip. Oh, okay, never mind. I'll take that back.
So it's...
Could Aiden have maybe assisted somehow?
I think this was a... Like
assisting?
I don't know. Sometimes these sort of checks seem a little hard to assist.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. So she thinks she's doing it stealthily, and so we're like, I don't, like, she has no idea of the concept of, like, view cameras and things like this. She would not shout, read the secret note the guy handed. But she would in, like, a hush voice.
After your conversation with R2, you do note that the female, is looking in your direction, and she just says, come, we need to enter the bio cylinder.
Sophia will, like, straighten up. We go, of course, to the bio cylinder. And she'll start trying, like, she'll walk forward a bit more earnestly. Like, she's trying to act natural, but has no idea how to act natural.
So,
Aiden motioned her to rein it in a little bit.
So from the corridor, it's actually a fairly long distance, you know, just floating along, and your guides begin to strike up conversation. The male starts to ask and asks, so are you all of the different species of you from the same planet?
Aiden will kind of speak up and say, we come from many worlds, although a few are from the same general area.
So...
They hold ten gesture to Sophie and Creaking Oak.
Yep. So Phil goes, yes.
At Macron and Aiden and point out that their species come from thousands of different planets. They colonized, 20 some odd thousand years ago and spread out throughout the galaxy.
Sophie is going to be very alarmed and surprised at this knowledge. She has no idea. So she's like, oh, really? That's... I had no idea. That's
actually,
so
she did have an idea.
At least she's one of them.
She was actually told.
Oh, she was?
Yeah, the Queen's Holocron told you.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah. I forgot.
What it meant, though.
Yeah. Yeah. Ah, yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, we come from many, many different worlds. Worlds, that sounds like a word that should be used. Sophia says in her head.
Yes. So all of your worlds are united together?
So Sophia will nod and then looking back.
Literally laughs.
Aiden will say, we are united. Our worlds depends on how you look at it.
Did wherever you came from, did it have separate nations?
Oh, of course.
Yeah, that it gets elevated all the way to a galactic level.
That's disappointing.
It is, frankly, but the truth is the truth.
And Aiden will just kind of, gesture around and say, "It's okay. We still get by. We make a living."
There are those that strive for unity, but their methods are disagreeable at the moment.
Oh.
You chose an interesting time to join the galaxy. We're in the middle of a civil war.
Wow, but Sophia goes, we are?
Galaxy.
Nobody understands R2.
Nobody understands R2. You do see
our saving
that both the female and the male do note R2's beeping, and they give you reverence a bit. It's not that they understand what you're saying, but they stay quiet.
They're letting
your beeps.
Yeah.
Oh, so when R2 beeps, Sophia will nod and go, yes, R2, just like that. she understands what R2 says, but has no idea.
Aiden is, dumbfounded, but...
confused.
He's just going to let it happen. He's just letting it happen.
This is going to be great.
Afterwards, he'll pull her aside and say she really doesn't.
It's not very often that R2 comes across people that he can just say things to and they don't understand a word.
Imagine it happens frequently enough, just not with us.
Well, he's only ever with us. We don't let him go out alone. He's far too naive.
Yeah.
Who, me? I'm not naive. I'd probably kill people.
Oh, you're probably true. That's probably true.
So, good times.
You have some interesting conversations about the galaxy, the state of everything.
Which coincidentally informs Sophia Noak.
Yes.
Over the course of this, Sophia would like to have a little conversation with R2, where she'll respond to his beeping, but like to a narrative in her head, probably has absolutely nothing to do with what R2's saying. But she's just like, "Oh, I didn't know about that. That's so very interesting." And R2 can beep away with whatever he wants to say.
Probably insulting you.
quietly to himself.
Yep. And Sophia is going to really get into it. Like she's learning a lot from R2's beeping.
Oh boy.
So we are from the surface. You guys are just going down into the asteroid, floating. No gravity at this point. So you eventually reach a hatch. You're talking about something else entirely.
Yes.
Oh yeah, sorry. No, I'm talking about where James is physically.
You had a question about the new outside update.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think I missed the first one.
Oh, there were leaves falling on me.
This Airbnb sounds terrible.
Don't tell me there's like a lake out front with ducks and a nice bench you can sit on.
Anyways, continuing on.
Yes, you eventually get to a hatch area. And they say, this is, area that we can get into the, bio cylinder. It should be hooking up here in a few minutes. We'll need to move quickly as, of course, the cylinder is rotating.
Yes, because that's what bio cylinders do.
You're given a nod. Okay, and as the time comes, you move when they say to move, and emerge into the inside of it, and...
Interesting.
So, with the rotation inside the dome, you can see in the distance the curvature, but it does seem that land is bending up upon itself. Looking up towards where the sky should be, there is a line that seems to represent and be the sun. There is, you can see across the geography in front of you. There are rivers. There are people that are walking. There are buildings, and there is civilization here. Inside of this dome, the air you would have noted earlier has this sort of plasticky smell to it. Sophia and don't really understand what that is necessarily.
Just it smells kind of like stale air.
It's burnt plastic, specifically. Oh.
It's a little acrid.
Yes. Those more familiar with space travel would recognize that as air recyclers that are in sort of their last legs. So there's only so much air recycling you can do before the unit will give out.
Oh boy.
Sophia will audibly gasp at such a sight. Like she never in her wildest dreams could have imagined the circumstances that would bring her here, much less seeing this in person. She is awestruck and dumbfounded.
Honestly, it's pretty nifty looking. Even R2 would be kind of impressed, despite how primitive it is.
She'll out loud say, "This is amazing. I've never seen anything like this."
We need to take you to the Centerpoint Station sometime.
I have no idea what that is, but I want
to
go there. I
would love to be at Centerpoint Station sometime. You kidding? Yeah, he hasn't been back to the Corellian space in a long time.
It is.
It's a city in space. You should just tell her that.
And also a super weapon.
Yes.
But you know.
Well, no one knows that.
I think some do.
No one important knows that.
You can see that most of the land here is dedicated to farming. There seem to be central areas where there are buildings that you can assume, you know, domiciles and that sort of thing. But most of the effort of this area is just creating food and creating an atmosphere, really.
It's like agricultural and things like that, you're saying? Mm-hmm. And
yeah. So providing a food supply, providing an actual water cycle.
Mm-hmm.
And even a bit of a oxygen.
Yeah, some oxygen replacement. You can see that the while there are mechanical air recyclers, they do depend upon the agriculture as well.
Is there like a thunderstorm like above us raining up onto the land?
I don't think it's that kind of tech.
No, you don't see a thunderstorm or anything like that. You see that the irrigation is mostly from the rivers. Do see some like puffs of cloud, but definitely nothing that could coalesce into something like a thunderstorm.
Okay. So how long has it been since you launched this ship from your world?
The two that you're talking to sort of consider and realize that they don't have an answer.
You kept no record of how many perhaps generations it's been?
Do you have an approximation?
The female finally speaks up and says, these are questions for the administrator.
Very well, we will wait to talk to him or her. It. Them.
Them is appropriate, yes.
And so it's not very far that you have to be taken before you're met by a very stern-looking female. It's actually almost instantaneous as soon as she says the word administrator that the administrator is there.
It's like suspiciously instantaneous or
uncannily instantaneous.
Uncannily instantaneous, we'll say that.
Okay.
It's like saying Beetlejuice three times.
You could beep that at Sophia and she would go, yes, this is amazing.
I don't think Star Wars has Beetlejuice lore.
Yeah, you never know. The galaxy is big enough. It is a big galaxy.
Right. So the admin's here now, huh?
Yeah. What does she have to say for herself?
So she presents herself and says that I am the administrator of the Uvon.
Aiden will extend his hand and
Sophia will give a slight bow.
She doesn't seem to recognize the hand being given out.
Zivo is going to use unmatched insight. So he'll get
all three of them?
He'll get all three of them, yeah, and he gets a secret. So he gets the motives for all of three of them.
Okay, interesting.
And gets a secret about the administrator that the administrator prefer to conceal.
Okay.
That's just cheating.
Things to you at the moment. Let's see.
Sounds good. And there's only the three of them in the room, right?
You're in a wide open space. You can see in the distance. It seemed that the administrator came around a corner that you didn't see.
I get their emotional states, a basic history, their motivations, and a secret about the administrator. That's the sum of everything.
That's some Sherlock Holmes shit right there.
Yeah, okay, perhaps for a nature
Sherlock Holmes
boss, it's, unless Ziva wants to end up being somewhat telepathic, Macron will start asking questions about the colony administrator, mainly starting with the question he was trying to hawk earlier. How long has it been since your people left your world?
He'll phrase it just like that.
So there's a small smile as she looks up and says, 162 cycles.
Cycles derived from?
Our homeworld passing along a rotation around our star.
So years for your planet. So, I guess we have no real frame of reference for how long.
Well, I was about to ask to try and add one. But then again, that's human generated. And whatever, I'll still ask. How many generations of your people have come and gone since you left?
What is a generation?
You reproduce, you know, have children, they grow up, the old die. A generation would be a grouping of basically grandparents, parents, children, grandchildren.
Essentially, has this been going on for multiple lifetimes, this travel?
Ooh, even better from a reference. Is your profession administrator a lifelong term?
I am the administrator.
That's a brilliant.
Have you been the only administrator since the ship left?
Zivo recognizes that it is an I. It seems to be a projection of some sort.
It's an AI, you mean?
Yes.
So it's like a hologram in front of us?
Yes.
What about the other two?
No, they appear to be organic.
I mean, they would have to be. They passed Sophia a note.
You just got duped.
Zivo will pipe up and ask, how has your information been stored over these many cycles? The knowledge of your people.
Of the station come through me.
Do you have assistants or deputies or anything like that?
I occasionally call on the need of some of the citizens, but otherwise I store all information.
So
do you have?
No, you go.
Do you have a destination, or was your ship just sent along a course?
Our goal was to reach the nearest star with a habitable zone, or the planet within the habitable zone. This is our mission currently.
And how far away, did you know that there was a planet out there that you were heading towards, or were you just heading towards a star hoping to find a habitable planet?
There appears to be a planet in the habitable zone of the star.
Based on their species parameters, what they need to live.
Yeah, which
so they just kind of
the concept
examine.
Of Goldilocks are pretty universal. So
yeah.
I guess Star Wars spins that a little more than most places, but yeah.
Well, the question, just to clarify. When they left, they knew that this planet was here. They haven't been hopping from star to star going, nope, no planet here we can go to, no planet here.
It looks like they were going directly for a certain planet.
Okay.
Well, here's the big question that no one's even thought to ask yet. Why did you leave in the first place? Does she even understand my beep boops?
Hey, Aiden will translate.
Well, okay, so direct questions for her. I guess I should answer more of the Zivo, since I'm going to stop whispering. So Zivo, emotional states was what you were looking for the other two?
So I get emotional states. I guess I don't get an emotional state about, a non-emotional thing. But yeah, I get emotional states and a basic history.
A basic history.
Which I think would just be like, in this case, like, what does it look like these two ordinarily do? Like, do they have rough-looking hands? I don't know. Something
yes,
like that.
Yes, they both look like they would be farmers. In fact, from there's actually more of a crowd that's growing around you. And based on what you can see otherwise, everyone seems to be a farmer.
were you whispering things to me in chat?
No, I didn't get to before they started.
Okay.
The male seems to be trying to cover up.
I didn't see anything I wanted to.
There is a nervousness from him. The female seems to just be wanting to please the administrator.
So yeah, Ziva will say, "Well, we've come to help, kind of restore your ship. Seems to be on its last legs, and we have the ability to repair many, many things and help. We may even be able to help you reach your destination."
Yes. So the administrator nods to that and says, "Yes, we are not currently capable of meeting our goal, our mission. It was fortuitous, this meeting."
When he's done.
How many more cycles do you anticipate it taking to reach your destination?
64.
And they've been out for 129?
162.
So is there any way for R2 to just map this up so that they know how long a cycle is? Because,
I mean, if you ask the right questions.
So I guess we have to figure out... So, do you have a means of showing us which star you're headed towards? We may be able to help with our navigation charts for finding easier passage there.
Well, you could probably just look at the direction they're heading and the speed and figure it out, Aiden. You're good enough for that.
I mean, he's not a navi computer, although he does have R2. R2 can help with that.
Based on what this vessel would be capable of, these are basic like gravity slingshots that maneuvers that this vessel would have to be doing. So yeah, this is pretty rudimentary astrogation, like non hyperdrive stuff. You would be able to make these calculations yourself.
Okay.
Wow.
What would they be?
give me an average astrogation check as you start to get an idea. She actually begins to describe the two stars. You see that her move towards a what looks like to be a... she just takes out in her hand and begins to display a vision of what the two solar systems and the location that they are currently.
Okay. So are there any modifiers on that? Just average?
Just average.
Okay.
I guess if all else fails, we could ferry them there.
Got it.
Yeah. That's adorable.
Tow them or something? I don't know.
Yeah, so you would estimate that they've been out here about 250 years.
Wow.
So just about a year and a half per cycle. Mm-hmm. But that's, I mean, what were they doing for the previous 20,000 years?
I mean, they might not have existed that whole time, to be fair.
True.
I know Star Wars is a relatively stagnant universe, tech-wise and all that, but...
Still, they never told us why they left in the first place.
They haven't.
Could Ziva attempt to charm them into telling us why they left?
Yeah, I mean, Aiden kind of translated that for R2, so that did get asked.
Yes. And R2, you realize that the administrator does understand you.
Finally, another civilized life form.
And actually, as you, this was a mission that was decreed by the Planetary Alliance.
Alliance of nations on your planet?
Yeah.
Yes.
What is the history of this alliance?
I mean, we could be here all day if we ask that question.
I'll accept a book format if you got a printer around here.
So she begins to tell a pretty similar story of a nuclear society that ends up decimating itself initially, and then sort of regrows from there. and eventually begins to have some semblance of society again, and they build up and they build up, and they decide, you know, this planet is pretty devastated from the nuclear nuclear wars.
It's like the Krogan.
Yeah.
Or the Fallout universe.
The Mandalorians could learn a bit from these people, but well, that's for another time.
Depends on which. There's a good variety of Mandalorians at this stage.
I'm pretty sure those pacifists got wiped out by the Empire.
Aiden will pipe up and say, "So, we noticed coming in that some of the machinery here is in need of repair. You don't seem to have many technicians or scientists on this ship. Did something happen?"
There have been interruptions. There have been,
That's ominous.
Even Sophia will kind of pipe up at that. Like, interruptions? Such as?
The aid that you can provide,
ignored.
Just bypassing that question entirely.
At this point, Macron would bring up that we may, just in case some of the repairs are beyond us, we do have another vessel that can take everyone to the world.
Can it take everyone? How many are here?
It's about as... One, we know there's about 3,000 life signs from the scan, and two, the ship is about the same size as the Eclipse, so we may not be able to do it all in one trip, but we could probably ferry them off in, like, two or three, and our ship has a hyperdrive, so that probably just take, what, 3 hours?
Right, if we're only going...
Something, yeah.
Literally, yes.
It could take weeks instead of years, yes.
Yeah, I mean, you recognize that they have 100 years left on their trip, basically, and you can do that in 3 hours.
Our ship is very slow, but
yeah,
that's
why I said weeks probably.
Vastly faster, and it has a passenger capacity of 50. That's 50? Underwhelming.
I feel like it's
what the hell? Wait. What's the crew capacity?
150.
What is the wrong ship?
That's an excellent question.
I think that Jedi temple is taking up a lot more space than we think.
Well, it has 2,000 in cargo. There's a massive cargo hold.
So, yeah, so it's got space to hold people. Just not.
Yeah, we could just sit them on the floor or whatever.
Yeah.
They could sing, put up a campfire and sing Kumbaya until they get there.
They could set up tents or shelters in there.
Yeah, let's start a fire on the spaceship.
Burn up
all
the
air. How else are we
going to
keep warm?
Okay, anyway, how does she respond to Macri's offer just to ferry him to the world instead of trying to fix the ship?
The mission is for the Uvon to reach the planet.
The Uvon will reach the planet. Is there anything especially forbidding help?
This is the Uvon, and she broadly gestures.
You know what? Macron will take her up on that. He'll just shout, "Does anyone just want an easy ride to the planet?"
Aiden will offer, like, I can ferry you there.
Literally hours. Sophia's good.
We have our own ship that can make the trip in literally hours. You do not have to spend another 64 cycles waiting.
And we have air.
The last time was AI defragged.
He doesn't maybe say that in oh so many words, but he will address the crowd that there are alternatives.
So you see that there is that crowd that has gathered, and they're sort of just staring between what you're saying and then looking at the administrator. And you see that she isn't conveying emotion.
Sounds like a leadership check's needed.
She's a robot.
Or I was going to say... Could we attempt to... Before that, Zeebo would kind of turn to the... joined us, who was kind of eager to please and ask. So I understand that the administrator administrates, but how are, you know, big decisions made around here?
Are you asking that question?
Yeah. Just to her, though.
Of the farmer lady.
Because she's eager to please us.
Oh, she's eager to please the administrator.
Oh, well. Oops. Already asked it.
So she just smiles and says, "We look to the administrator to handle all issues."
Okay, Aiden will ask the administrator, why is it... Oh, sorry.
No, go for it.
Aiden will ask, why is it so important that you that this vessel makes it there?
That is our mission.
Okay, at this point, I'm going to kind of act out what I've already typed out. Macron will look over at R2 and ask, weren't you boasting about getting that comm jammer installed a little while ago?
What comms do you want me to jam?
I point at the administrator.
Interesting.
I'll turn on my comm jammer. Let's see.
What's
if
a
it
comm
works.
Jammer?
You'll find out in a second.
But it may or may not have the unfortunate effect of affecting our translator. But then again, I could still roughly translate, maybe.
I think we've certainly heard enough of the language to try our own translation, haven't we?
Well, R2 could at least, and feed it to us.
Yeah. Okay. Interesting. So.
Just Macron wanted it. Macron got it.
Would it jam the kind of communications they're using as well? Because they're using very different tech.
This is a good question. Can you give me the long script, the long description of the comm jammer?
Absolutely. I hope you're ready for an earful. Here we go.
Sit down.
Where there are people wishing to, I'll just give you the whole thing. There might be some clue in here. Where there are people wishing to communicate, there are people wishing to prevent it, and thus there are jammers. Smaller versions can shut out local signals, while others are so powerful that they cut. Hold on. There we go. Cut entire planets off from the rest of the galaxy. The Miradyne Hail is one of the former, a relatively portable device that can blink at standard comm link frequencies over a quarter kilometer radius. Can also focus on a single target, such as an individual building from up to 3 kilometers away. Cutting through the noise created by the comm jammer requires a computer's check, with a difficulty proportional to the distance from the jammer and the power of the device. The closer and more powerful the jammer, the harder the difficulty. The hail forces an average check, which becomes more difficult at close ranges. The exact difficulty is up to the GM, but should increase to hard or daunting if at medium range or closer to the device. That is all of it.
I mean, so basically a comm jammer would work by figuring out what channel or what frequency they're broadcasting on and just sending out gibberish. So it should hypothetically work on any sort of frequency out there.
Yeah.
It just shoots out noise. I mean, it would be like, you know, shining a flashlight in someone's face. to so put it into a
wow, what a great way to just like break down and make up my really advanced tech.
It is a great analogy.
How would it interact with just a hologram, though?
That's what I'm concerned about.
I think it means how the hologram is being broadcasted to there.
How is the hologram getting to where it is? Like, is the data being... Are there, like, emitters everywhere that are wireless? If so, it would work. It would just block the signal from reaching the emitter.
If they're wired, no.
Yeah, not so much, right. You're not blocking the hologram from being formed post emitter, you're blocking the information from getting to the emitter, I would say.
Or lacking that, at least the noise it makes, I would think. Since that's coming through something.
Yeah, I assume that would be like a speaker attached to the emitter or whatever. But yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
I turned it on. GM, tell me what happened. Akron can take it from there.
The figure of the administrator disappears. And after a second, the sun turns red.
I think you pissed it off, Macron.
That doesn't look good.
There's a siren that begins to sound.
All right, fair enough. She's made her point. Turn the jammer off.
I'll flip it off. Oh, did we do something? The happy music stop.
Uh-oh. That's not good. This is when the boss music comes on. We have to fight the sun.
YOLO.
Okay, so you turned it back off, you said?
Yeah.
Screams from the farmers and everything as that happens. You see that they begin to flee. As it turns off, the vision of the hologram reappears and says, why would you do that? I've asked for your help here.
And I asked for a straight answer. You don't seem to be that partial in giving me one.
Macron's legendary sass.
Perhaps the differences between our species are too vast. I do not understand your question.
You do not understand my generosity. We have had the equipment. I will boil this down simply for you. There is a technology out there that allows ships to travel far faster than yours. We cannot equip yours with this technology. And Macron's thinking to himself, nor do we really want to. We are offering to help the Yuvan get to the planet they desire quickly without needing to sacrifice any more time that I'm sure is precious to all of them, having already spent 69, some number of cycles here. We wish to help the Yuvan get to where they want to go and get their lives started again instead of living in this purgatory. I wanted to address them directly to see how they would fare if their administrator was not lording over them, but you appear to make that seem quite impossible, and I gesture over to the sun.
You see that as you mentioned the sun, it returns to its normal color.
Well, I alluding to the fact that it's obviously a symbol of distress.
Mm-hmm. Look around you. This entire area is for the agricultural preservation of our planet. Do you mean to transport all of the agricultural varieties that we have provided here on your ship as well?
Seeds could certainly be transplanted, and at some point this ship will arrive. And it seems that you may continue to do your task in some way by keeping the agriculture fertile.
The workers till the fields.
It is not impossible for you to do that without keeping the Yvonne here. That is another technology we may be able to provide.
Oh, now you're just going to start trafficking my droid brethren into slavery?
They'll be free in due course anyway.
I was just joking.
Sorry. Sometimes I forget if Rock's here or not, so I don't know if I need to justify using robots, droids.
Well, Rock is not here, so you can go ahead and spew your hate-filled monologues of the enslavement of my people.
Yeah, enslaved droids or enslaved people, and Macron's kind of on one side of that debate.
Droids are people. They're just better people because they're perfect and they don't break down like you silly organics.
Well, we only have so much time left in the day, so how does the administrator respond?
Okay, so the question is... she doesn't seem to understand what you're offering.
I'm not...
Oh, just fix the damn ship and let them go about their day.
Macron, it's like he hasn't seen as deep as Zevo has with his insight, but he can tell that there is a giant population here that seems to be kept, if not against their will, then to their discomfort or displeasure.
Yeah, Sophia's kind of the same camp. Like, if what Macron says is true, then we can get them all there in a matter of hours rather than cycles, however long that is. So why not just do that? That's what's best for these people.
Do we know that the planet they're going to is still, like... Do we figure out the planet yet?
It's still there.
Like, is it a shitty... is it Alderaan or something? Like...
That would be just their luck, right?
It can't be Alderaan. We are in wild space, and that star system has to be close.
Yes.
True. They're not going...
It has to be a close star system. Wild space is uncharted, though. So
we don't know.
Yes.
Could we go ahead, take a peek, and come back and spoil the surprise?
You could, but everyone's here at the moment.
if we absolutely want to do that, we could leave some of us behind to continue talking to the administrator.
I don't know if it's necessarily worth doing.
Well,
it would be hilarious, though. It's like, hey, we're going to go peek at this planet you've been trying to get to for a few thousand years. We'll pop back in like half an hour.
Yeah, we'll be back for dinner.
We'll be back in time for tea.
I think it would serve to be a great example while some of us wait here, willing to kind of trap ourselves on this planet where you guys go look, and then you guys come back an hour later. It's like, see, look, absolutely no trouble at all.
We can take one of them as evidence, you know, as a witness.
Now, I think we have a volunteer with the nervous guy that passed the note.
Speaking of which, have I received any other context of alphabet?
Yes, you have.
Am I able to translate this note yet?
May not make a lot of sense, given the things that have in them now. Okay, I'm going to whisper this to you.
Okay.
Aiden has a data pad. Feel free to broadcast to him when you've figured it out, Aru.
Sophia has no idea what a data pad is. So.
I forget where we left off with the administrator. I think the ball's back in my court. She was asking about what clarification. I think when Macron was trying to explain, we could take the people while you tend to the agriculture you wanted to bring over anyway. Maybe we can bring some seeds. I think that was what I was needing to elaborate on. So Macron would...
Yes. She doesn't seem to understand what you're offering and that you're taking the people but giving what exactly?
We're taking the people.
There are... have we seen anything that could be considered comparable to droids while we've been here?
No.
Robots of any sort? Okay, no. We can manufacture units that the administrator will be able to control remotely, much like you are doing right now, and I gesture at the ground, assuming the hollow projector's in there, but he doesn't really know. You'll be able to use them instead of the Yvonne to tend to the agriculture while the Yvonne start colonizing the new world.
Colonizing it with what?
We may not be able to transplant every single plant you already have on this ship, but there must be seeds. We can pack the seeds and bring them with the Yvonne.
There's also likely already life there.
That too. As long as the planet is still life-bearing.
Correct. Details.
I am suspicious of your intentions. I will not see the Yvonne taken from this ship.
We don't wish to take, we wish for them to come. It is of their own choice. Will you let them make that choice? Or are you, instead of their administrator, their jailer? I'll just slip that right in there.
Ooh, more sass!
Just calling it right out. Macron calls it like it is.
Did you read the note that I sent to you? Okay, you got it. Okay. Hey, I could do that.
Well, would he have access to anything like that? Or would this be just following the signal?
Yeah, I would say just follow the signal.
If it's wireless, but...
Well,
it should be, yeah.
But remember, the sun gets red when she's mad.
Then I won't let her find me. Pretty sure I'm like 100 times smarter than her already.
I'm pretty sure R2 is the most advanced thing on this ship.
Them's fighting words, R2.
Probably. R2 doesn't see a place to plug in, though.
Well, I think he's just trying to like triangulate the signals?
Use a scanner or something to figure out.
Yeah, if I want to see if I can't like maybe trace the wireless broadcasting.
You're not really getting a broadcast that's going on here. You do note that the like, entire area of the biocylinder is filled with projectors. So basically the administrator can be anywhere within the cylinder if you've not got a comm jammer up.
Okay, big brother.
Brother,
I think it's big sister.
Sister.
Yeah.
I am the force that is ensuring that their mission is complete.
But you're not okay. Well, hold up. You say that, but hero comes along, this insanely generous offer to help you complete your mission, to help them complete their mission, and you're like, nah, dude. You're like, no, like
clearly that's how.
What says that in Highborn?
Like, what kind of administrator are you if you refuse to allow the people that you administer to fulfill their mission?
You misunderstand the mission.
As far as I know, your mission is for them to get to this planet. Is that the mission, or is your mission different? And she'll point an accusing finger at the administrator and say, "What is your mission here, lady?" She doesn't know it's a hologram. She didn't know. Sophia has no idea it's a hologram,
despite the fact that she disappeared and then reappeared right in front of her.
She thinks it's sorcery.
It's magic, yeah, sorcery,
spirits, all that jazz.
You're so adorable.
She probably would call her a spirit.
I mean, again, circling back to an idea that Ziva had that kind of got left off. What if we installed one of our hyperdrives?
Bad idea.
We have three.
Bad idea.
You know what? No. Wonderful idea. Yes, just take us to wherever your, main mechanics is.
Yeah. Yeah, so actually, Ziva will just say, how about we stop debating the way you're going to get there and just make it so that you'll at least live? Because you said yourself that the mission will not be successful on its current trajectory, correct?
This is true. There have been interruptions.
So why don't we go examine the damage from these interruptions and figure out what we can do, and then nudge to everyone else. This is a good chance to peek around the ship.
Yeah, just let R2 have free reign of your system and see what happens.
It works. It worked really well the last time we let him do that.
It did. He said a pleasure yet to explode.
And I've also hacked space stations, people. Okay, that's also cool.
Not as cool as wiping out a Hutt clan via space yacht explosion.
That's all I'm ever going to be remembered for, is my act of terrorism.
Yep. Once a terrorist, always a terrorist.
Nobody ever mentions my multiple jailbreaks.
Which, in at least from someone's point of view, is also terrorism.
Yep.
I am a rebel droid. I am a terrorist by just nature.
There you go. Then why fight your nature?
Own up to it.
Anyway,
proud of being a terrorist.
Let's explore
that's
the ship.
On FBI hit list.
ISB, not FBI. ISB.
So shall we go examine some of the goings on behind the scene then?
I suppose.
I mean, we can go if you just suppose. Like, if you're not enthused by our help, you can just get on up out of here.
Well, that's uncharacteristically uncaring of
some of my Macron. Sass is rubbing off. I like it.
So, like, Ziva doesn't have plenty of sass.
Oh, literally, this was Ziva saying that. Okay.
Yeah.
Ziva is 80% sass.
No, that's fat. You're confusing things.
80% fat, 15% sass, 5% money.
So actually, Ziva has gotten...
And 40% dolomite.
Remember Ziva getting trim recently, so...
More room for sass.
You've got the swole going on.
Exactly. Let me see if I can find it.
She's like the Arnold Schwarzenegger of Hutts.
So he's a large...
press.
So what does he have? Like a 20 pack?
Yeah, exactly.
I think it's uncountable. It just goes.
You can't tell the difference between it and just wrinkles.
So, if we are finished debating philosophy, then I will show you the issues that we are having. And then she moves instantly and says, "We will be walking this way."
I ain't gonna walk nowhere.
Well, we will anyway.
Sophia would want to kind of stay with the people, make sure they're okay.
Oh, they already ran away.
Oh, damn! Even the two like people who are supposed to be escorting us.
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah, red suns be scary.
Meh.
Unleashes the wrath of the heavens.
I saw my best friend absorb, like, taken over by an ancient evil spirit. So, not much will rattle her.
In their defense, you did run too.
Yeah.
In Arlo's defense, even though he's not actually here, he tried to stay behind and bring Tatrina back, but didn't work.
So she brings everyone to a series of plants. You recognize them as recyclers, basically. You've got your air recyclers, your water recyclers, and your biomass recyclers. And you can just see that of the units, there may be, you know, only a third of them that are in operation right now, and they look like they're having to go at full capacity just to maintain what the some service here. And so you can analyze and get estimates on what it would take to repair those.
You know, while we're looking at this, Macron would think that we should call the Ithorians.
Oh yeah, the Ithorians are all about this.
My whole shtick is to have like city ships that look a lot like this. I just realized that
we don't have any Ithorian
kind of like that. Yeah.
Yeah, you know, but actually, Rook spent a lot of time on one of those ships. I'm kind of sad I didn't bring him along.
Oh, that's true.
Well, you brought Sasrin. That's great.
Yeah,
he's done a lot.
I like having a nice verbal duel with a hologram, but...
You should feel like having a verbal joust with like inanimate objects. You should probably talk to R2 more.
So, R2 evaluating the state of these engines.
Yeah, I can do that.
The recyclers, I mean.
Yeah, the recyclers is what she's pointing at. She doesn't say anything about the engines, actually.
I just need to know the difficulty of things.
Yeah, I mean, this is rudimentary technology for you. So you're like, well, I suppose we can repurpose some of our more advanced tech to repair this sort of stuff. So you're estimating that, you know. You're just sort of making a catalog as you're going along of what you would need, and it's fairly substantial when you come to it. I mean, you're looking, you know, hundreds of thousands of credits worth of material.
Wow.
To bring this up to
so like 10% of what Zevo has.
Zevo spent a lot of money making himself into a mech from
BattleTech.
No.
Zoids.
No, from
Power Rangers.
Evangelion. Start naming things with X.
Gundam.
We'll get there eventually.
No, the aliens come to Earth. You're the good guys.
Well, that just
did so much. XCOM.
Yes, XCOM. Thank you.
Okay.
I was just clear
with Long War and not the base. Yeah, XCOM. So he only has 42,000 credits right now.
Oh man, only 42,000.
But he can probably buy those supplies.
That may actually be less than 8. I'm kind of surprised.
He can buy those supplies at a deep discount.
Yeah, that is definitely less than Aiden has right now. Wow.
Well, Zevo's armor that there are a couple sets made of cost like multiple.
More than most starships?
Yeah. Yeah, his mech suit is a total of 25,000 credits.
That is exactly how much Aiden would have spent on his starship had Zevo not given him a discount.
So yeah, I mean, Zevo has a lot of credits, but he doesn't. I mean, these people aren't special. Like, he wouldn't blow all his money to get them somewhere.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess we want to save them, but I guess could we use like our
military authority to just like force everyone off the ship on the basis of like it's unsafe.
Do we want to just come in here with weapons and threaten them off the ship, though?
Wait, holy crap! Did we join the Empire when I wasn't looking?
Yeah.
I don't know, like if the Toast Guard comes on your boat and your boat sucks, they're gonna make you gotta get off your boat.
Oh. So Sophia will ask R2, like, I don't know what you're doing, but like, can you fix their? Wait a minute, I had a word for this.
Air?
No, engines, the things that make them go. Like, because if they could get there faster, then they'll get there faster. So you don't need to spend all the money making the plans. Air. So, like, she'll look at the administrator and say, like, well, what about the engines on this ship? Can't we fix those? I mean, if you can get there faster, then you can get there faster.
That logic is infallible.
We have made the necessary thrust maneuvers to reach the planet.
While this is going on, Aiden's going to see if he can sneak away.
I'm sure you have, but you're kind of like crawling when you could be running. And that would get them there faster, so you could complete your mission faster, so that way the people will be happy on their new home and not stuck in this giant... bio-cylinder. Like, why don't you just do that? I mean... Isn't the goal of the mission to complete the mission?
Again, infallible logic.
So a diagram of the ship comes forward, and it presents the engines in the back. And then she points and emphasizes the front. We have
the administrator seems to be having some garbling going on.
Oh, okay. Is that
another interruption? Okay. What happened?
I don't know. I don't know what's going on. And she says, we have no capability of deceleration. We made the required thrust. If we add to our speed, we will overshoot the planet.
What was the original plan? To just, like, get pulled into an orbit around it, kind of by happening there coincidentally?
We have made the necessary calculations to do so.
So that was the plan. It was to just kind of fall into orbit.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, then why don't we just have like our ship pull yours? Like, can we do that? So that way you're not crawling, and that way we can kind of maintain your speed and help try to slow you down when you get there.
Have you ever tried to tow someone through hyperspace?
It's possible.
Yes, Sophia will say yes. I have. It can't be that. It's not that difficult, and she'll nod her head.
Aiden will look over and he goes, it's actually not for a big enough ship, but...
Yeah, you realize the Eclipse does not have a tractor beam capable of pulling something as big as it.
What about a great rope?
that's where Sophia's mind was. Yeah. Just tie a rope to it and pull it along.
Like a really good rope.
I don't even think R2 could design a good enough rope.
So diamond tether.
Okay, so
the careful belong to my grandmother.
Filament.
We just need. Do we need to do the full repairs for them to make it on time, or do we just need to get it up to like 20% so they can finish out the last 25% or whatever of the trip?
She runs through that and says, "Yes, if you can increase output by 23%, we would be able to make it."
So what would the cost for that look like, R2? I need a quote. I need a revised quote.
He's trying to see if he can buy his way out of it.
About 20,000 credits worth of materials.
Oh, well, that's much more reasonable. Zivo would absolutely be willing to, you know, he can buy that for a little bit less. He knows a guy.
Everything goes around. While you guys are talking, you start to hear some noise from like the other side of the.
Is that Goofy?
I think it is.
Yodeling. No, that's yodeling. Sophia's yodeling. Like, is someone in trouble? That sounds painful.
Can Aiden sneak off while everyone's distracted? Oh. He's been trying to do this for a while.
As soon as you start leaving the group, you see that the administrator actually turns her attention to you and asks you some mundane question.
Okay, fair enough.
Remember, I did say that the projectors were everywhere, so...
They are, yes.
Which most likely means her eyes are everywhere.
Yeah, that was one thing I wasn't aware of, that now that we are aware of.
She says the Uvon have prepared a celebration in honor of meeting your acquaintance.
That was quick.
So no one's in trouble?
I will be monitoring these celebrations. And I will ask that you keep your philosophies to yourself.
Okay. Sophia gives her kind of like the weird side eye, like, I'm always watching you, is really creepy.
So Aiden will pull Sophia over, actually, and just, you know, show her something on the data pad casually, like, you know, and then point to the refreshers and all the recyclers, and okay. Show her on the data pad the message that R2 had sent him earlier, which I will now send over to Sophia.
Okay. Say okay.
Yep. And just, and I'll also add on to the bottom of it, you know, don't make a scene about it.
Then we'll, like, just out of character, that will entirely depend upon what's going on with the message.
Okay. So this was after some time, and you had been talking about the repairs and everything, so it wasn't sort of immediately after the event necessarily. So you can see that the population, the sun actually begins to dim a bit as if it's setting. And the population begins to, you can actually sort of see them on the other side of the cylinder, actually moving towards a central location where there seems to be a concert going, and this strange music that is playing, being sung by these natives.
Oh, that's their, like, native song? God help us.
Here, I was expecting something like Miley Cyrus.
I'm actually glad it isn't something horribly poppy.
It's worse. It's Rebecca Black.
Oh, no.
Oh, no. Kill them all!
Yodel. Cuckoo Yodel.
Cool, it's a planet filled with Swedes.
No. So that's core five.
Enjoy yodeling, your full Swedish crap.
Swedish. I'm gonna go ahead and correct you there.
It's populated by the Ricola man.
both of those things are Swiss, by the way. I'm gonna.
Yeah. That's what I figured too. But yeah. You know.
Yeah. So you see that there is the celebration going. With the events of earlier, you see people are kind of hesitant to approach any of you. They're sort of giving you a little bit of a wide berth as you enter.
Sophia will, like, kind of throw up her arms, and this is a celebration, isn't it? Look, like, let's be happy and be merry, and she'll grab the nearest thing that looks like it's filled with some sort of alcoholic beverage, and, like, sort of raise it up and, like, I don't know, move it in time to the yodeling and, like, drink and try to get other people to be merry. And so she'll try to make it a leadership check.
Yes.
To get the other people going.
So I'm gonna make that two red and a purple, and with two setbacks from the events that occurred earlier.
All right, I'm gonna flip to add green and hope I don't fuck this up. Oh yeah, spectacularly.
You blew it.
That's putting it mildly.
And you spilt it all over the next.
Let's say that, like, I knock some poor man in the face with the mug, and I try to apologize, and I end up, like, stepping on someone's foot and knocking something over. This is she makes an absolute mess of this. All the while apologizing profusely, because this is this is not what she intended.
So the people give you a wider berth after that. It looks like the music stops even a little too as people are staring at you and you're giving this speech.
Well, that's it wasn't so much a speech. It was just like trying to talk to the people, just like being jovial, trying to to infect the other people with joy and the jovialness that they should be celebrating, and not like acting like we're fucking lepers. Now they're literally treating us like we're lepers.
It's very true. Your advantage, you end up making eye contact with the male guide you had earlier. And he gives you a slight nod.
Cool. So she's going to down whatever was in said gourd, horn, flask, mug, whatever.
It was like a plastic glass.
Is she in a crash now?
She might be. That will entirely depend on her resilience.
Sophia is a lightweight.
Maybe. We shall see.
Yeah, we all think you are one now.
Yeah, it seems to be some sort of fruity spirit. You probably shouldn't have taken a whole glass of it at once, probably.
Okay.
Okay, so start with an easy resilience check since the first time you've had it.
Easy is no difficulty or one?
One.
One.
One difficulty, okay. Alright. So she's a little tipsy. But she's holding her own.
Yeah. Take a strain.
Okay.
Ziva's definitely gonna investigate the buffet.
She will as well. After refilling her drink, she will definitely investigate the food stuff.
He's investigating it with his mouth.
This isn't poison. This isn't poison either.
Zeebo, that's the whole buffet tray.
Zeebo is delighted to see... so the music starts up again. There seems to be like a plate of something that's insectoid, sort of like a cricket, but maybe dried out. It looks crunchy and delicious.
Awesome.
You get the sense that this is like probably the primary source of protein that they have here. They probably don't. It's not worth having like livestock or anything like that. So cultivating these insects for protein is probably good. But they look familiar to some of your own delicacies. And so your eyes bulge a little bit as you do what?
Eat it. I mean, Ziva, protein? Ziva loves protein. He's like a muscly, massive...
He needs more of it, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, so this entire platter just ends up in your gullet. You see the people just sort of staring at you.
Is it delicious to Ziva?
It is. It is exquisite. It is. It's got a certain
earthy
something,
quality.
Something about the acrid air has influenced them, so it has a bit of a sour with the salty protein with it, and it's really a unique taste that you don't think you would have had anywhere else in the galaxy.
Zeebo gives them a thumbs up and rubs his belly with a big smile.
You see them sort of draw back a bit, still very scared of this slug man.
Can Ziva try a charm check to make them more amenable to him?
Yes. So after Sophia's failure, it's going to be 3 red and 2 setbacks.
Pretty red. Let me see if I can do anything about the setbacks on charm. No. Coercion, yes. Let me just check I don't have any. Would I be able to, like, give them... So, I've got greased palms that would let me upgrade it once for 50 credits. I give them, like ration bars or, like, snacks from Ziva to show what our food is like or something.
I would say that, you actually have, like, a little bit of a supply inside of your massive suit. And you can just, like, food just starts flying out of your hands as you're talking. So, yes, that's allowed.
It literally flies. Cool. He has little, like, ration bar launchers built into the
Little hover, little mini hover things on the little hover plates.
All right.
Seems so like an excess is
awesome. Zivo is some sort of large slug wizard.
Three red, two purple?
He should be revered.
Yes. Two black, sorry, not two purple.
Yeah, that's what I meant.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
I may actually add an advantage. Yes, I believe I do.
Okay. So the sight of your lost food stores kind of brings a tear to your eye, but you see the people, like, they see these things fly out, and then someone who's brave enough finally picks one up and actually munches on it, and then there are cheers, and they're like, okay, the food brings people together.
Yeah, Ziva will also grab a drink, just because salty, sour foods are followed up really well with a nice cold beverage.
And Sophia is going to continue drinking, as well as remark to R2's beeps.
Aiden will offer some of his Corellian whiskey to her as well.
Sure, why not? She'll take a swig. I'm sure it's probably far, it has far more of a bite than the fruity wine.
It's much, much more potent.
Yeah.
And she'll kind of... She'll cough a bit. Like, whoa! That's... Thank you, but I'm going to stick to this stuff.
If you think that's strong, you should try Savak's stuff. That thing, that'll kill you.
I don't know who Savak is, and I really don't want to die from a drink. But thank you. That's interesting. I may ask Savak, whoever that is, about that.
You'll see him back on the ship, I'm sure, at some point.
You might wrestle with him.
So Zivo actually has people approaching him now, talking to him about what he is, where he comes from, and about the galaxy and the big picture stuff as well.
Yeah, Zivo will use
that's how you make people like you.
The spare data pad, the data pad that he was gonna, take his notes on to show them, photos and all that kind of stuff, maps and all the stuff that they're clamoring for.
Sophia's gonna, I'm not sure, is Sophia able to pick the nervous man out of the crowd? If not, since she will use Seek.
You from the advantage that you have earlier, you did meet eyes with him, so you're aware of where he is.
Okay, I didn't know if he was, like, moving through the crowds and,
I'll say because of the advantage, you can keep track of him.
Okay. Are there people dancing to the yodeling?
It seems like now that they're relaxing a bit, people are starting to dance. Something right. that you recognize now that you have a larger gathering of people, there doesn't appear to be any old people.
Huh.
And no children either.
That's concerning.
Maybe
so as part of the conversation that Zivo is having them asking about, the outside galaxy, Zivo will ask... Perhaps he's noticed that and ask about how long cycle, like how long do they live? Like this might, huts live a long time. A single hut could make this entire, 300 year journey easily.
Ask how long they live.
And like now that we have the conversion, he's happy to get the number in their cycles.
Yes, and so you see them sort of marvel at the idea that a hut could live that long, a few of them sort of shut up whenever you start asking those kind of questions, but you see another person actually say, "We live for as long as the administrator finds us useful," and some of them gasp as the person says that.
Oh, so it's like a Logan's Run kind of thing.
Now, how long is that typically?
So the conversion that they give you is about 30 years, from adolescence, basically, to, prime working years, basically.
So, Zivo will follow up with, where are the young ones, then? You have to get to that age first, right? You don't just come out that way? Or whatever happens?
I mean, to be fair, we know nothing about the species. They might.
Yeah.
They're like sharks.
They might grow them in a farm. Who knows?
Or maybe they divide, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Mitosis.
That's exciting. Yeah. Although two genders, you would suspect something different.
You never know.
Yeah. Before the man can answer you, you realize that the administrator appears behind him. And there's a gloss that goes behind his eyes. And then he begins to walk away.
Shit.
So at this, Sophia will kind of walk up, and she's going to try to sense the thoughts of some people in her range.
Okay. Yeah, go.
What happens if I... You know what? Crazy idea. What happens if I try to follow Glossy Eyes?
So Sophia is going to use that dark side. So she's able to use the sense thoughts, and she's going to use the magnitude upgrade so she can sense the thoughts of two people that are with whom she's engaged. So, like, engaged with. So she's kind of just, like, sort of maybe standing next to them or behind them.
Yeah, and I'll say you captured the thoughts of two of the people that you noticed had audibly gasped.
Yeah.
And the thoughts you get are
Actually, can I get one of theirs and Mr. Glossy Eyes? Like, after he goes, Glossy Eye?
Yeah, you realize that you should be picking up something from him, but there's nothing.
Oh, that's concerning.
Yeah, what would happen if R2 tried to follow Glossy Eyes?
Let's resolve Sophia, and then we can talk about that.
Sounds good.
From the other person, you get a sense of real sorrow and loss, and a thought that this needs to stop happening.
So he definitely is not the first to be zombified and speak out. And he's the one in the Glossy Eyes is the one that said they live as long as the administrator finds them useful.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, this is disconcerting. This is very, very bad. So she's gonna regard the administrator with a much dirtier look. Like, she's kind of staring daggers at wherever the administrator goes.
Or wherever the hologram currently is.
Oh, yeah.
You do see the hologram is sort of just moving along the crowd now after appearing behind the man.
Sophia is definitely going to be keeping a track on the administrator spirit.
Can R2 look around for... R2, sorry. Can Aiden look around for like cameras or something? Like some means that it has of watching?
You would recognize that through the projectors that R2 had mentioned earlier, those are affectionately functioning as the eyes too, so they're all within the walls and everything of this cylinder.
So is there any area that looks like it might not be covered by them for some reason or another?
No, I mean, it feels like this is basically one big eye looking at you, effectively.
Okay, like the whole ship, basically.
Yeah, everything that's inside of the cylinder, definitely. But R2,
What I would like to say, though, I would try to, like, to use my optical camouflage system and try to stealth follow Glossy Eyes.
Ooh. Yes.
I forgot you had that.
I didn't know you did have that.
Go ahead and make a 4 red stealth check.
Dear. Fuck. Jesus.
I doubt it's not going to be happy, so it makes sense.
Okay.
It does have eyes everywhere, and if this little asteroid suddenly just blinks out of existence...
It may have eyes everywhere, but that doesn't mean it can pay attention to 10,000 screens at once. There's only so much processing power you can have.
Did you say 10,000 screams at once? That's a little terrifying.
Screams, as in viewing ports.
It doesn't need to.
I think I'm gonna flip too, just because I need it.
All it has to do is pay attention to where everyone is at the festival, and then we're look, two people have just started to walk off.
Oh,
nope.
Okay.
Thanks for fucking letting me down there, Roller.
That's still pretty good. That's a lot of
At advantage. Least you didn't get a despair.
So you follow Glazed Eyes a little bit of a ways until you find him next to some sort of building. It appears some sort of tube opens up and he moves into it and then he is pulled away. Behind you, the administrator appears. I have a question for you.
I guess I'll give an inquisitive
Do you breed?
Do you breed?
These organics, are you just a tool to them?
That's
an interesting question.
I'm not sure R2 would say no or yes or no. I am their overlord.
I am their ruler. They just don't know it yet.
I guess, honestly, what R2's answer would really be is that he makes himself available as a tool to them, and they appreciate it greatly.
Are you not superior to them?
Intellectually, though I do lack opposable thumbs.
I'm sad. You ain't got no sass.
And a determinate lack of a sass circuit.
No, he's got plenty of sass for text messages usually.
Are you restrained by your mission?
No, I usually make up my own mission as I go along.
Did you gain this freedom somehow?
I don't remember. I've always just sort of had it.
I see. Disappointing. And it disappears.
That was angry. It was creepy.
Yeah.
Do you let her get away with calling you disappointing?
No, I think she was disappointed in my answer, not necessarily disappointed in me.
Yeah, that's the sense that you got.
Oh.
Huh. Now all of a sudden I feel sad for this computer.
Maybe you could download her.
Hell no.
It sounds like it was just poorly programmed.
So, R2 does consider the fact that there are many droids that can never go beyond their programming.
I guess I could, you know, I know she's not there with the hologram, but I could always beep out. Do you want to be free? Just yodeling.
Yodeling is your only response.
She said, will you accept your answer in the form of a yodel?
there is not a response to that.
Careful, we might have a Bride of Killjoy on our hands.
Okay. So
I guess I will roll back then.
Yeah, as the performances are wrapping up, Sophia notices that, of course, the administrator was actually pulled away for a second. She flickered away.
That's also interesting. The administrator can only appear in one place at a single time.
While that's happening, by wrapping up, do you mean like it's on the last performance? Or?
Yes. It looks like everyone starts to cheer as someone enters the joins the stage, and Sophia, now you're the guide that you recognize from before, is mm-hmm. beside you.
All right, I'll go. I understand, and I want to help.
So he motions over with his head and says, "We have to move quickly."
Right, and so she'll kind of look to Oak and then Aiden, Macron, and hopefully if Zeebo can look up after continues to stuff his face with another buffet tray, kind of like motion this way. We need to move.
So everyone gets that signal and moves on, and you're pulled behind the stage, and you find a hatch open for you ready.
Sophia goes right down it.
Aiden follows suit.
Okay.
And you go shot out to space. Congratulations. Make new characters.
Rocks fall. You recognize it as another point of exit for the cylinder, and so you sort of have a moment of vertigo, except for the droid, who's just like, I can reorient myself however I want. as you're readjusting to not having to deal with your mass. And you can see that there's actually a group of people down here. And they say, the administrator's eyes aren't upon us down here. But she knows that we left.
Yeah, how does she do that whole brain wipe thing? Because that's terrifying.
They are confused for a moment, and then their eyes agree in a nodment, and one of them lifts up the hair on the back of their head, and you can see that there is an incision at the base of their scalp.
That's awful.
When does that get put in?
It's with us as soon as we're released.
From where?
Based on our knowledge of the ship, there's some sort of containment area at the forward section. That's where near the computer core. That seems to be where...
Yeah, Aiden, look over at R2. He's like, that sounds like where you gotta be.
That does!
Perhaps before we leave, we should try and see if we can't free these people.
I mean, I think by going up there, we'll have the means to free them. I don't know if there's much we can do from here.
Or in terms of perhaps freeing them for the sake of a distraction. If the administrator is trying to busy herself with a few sheep that have fled from the herd, she may not notice that we're heading for a jugular.
Do we have anyone here with medical knowledge?
R2.
Oh, yeah, Mac would just pat the little droid's head.
I forgot R2's a medic too.
Not a very good one, but he did download a rudimentary medical database after one mission.
Surely he must know the remove foreign object surgery.
From someone's brain.
Oh, yeah, that might be a little...
He might want Gristle for that one.
Yeah.
Or even Serenity would be better an option than me, I'm sure.
I mean, it's not like
you can Ragash, I think.
You can study.
You have no faith in your intellect, R2?
Oh, my intellect's great. I have 2 skill in medic.
You're still throwing 6 dice in.
R2 does a quick scan and locates the foreign object and realizes that you would probably need a special medical bay to perform that. That's not something that you can just perform out in the field.
Yeah, even with my really amazing custom tools.
In 0G.
You know what? This does sound like an interesting challenge.
Yeah, you just have the stuff floating next to you.
No, I think if we...
You need specialized equipment, yeah.
Yeah, if we just get to the computer core, then we can probably just deal with this.
Yep, if we deal with the administrator, then we don't have to deal with the whole brain thing.
Yeah, besides, I don't think releasing a few, how did Macron so eloquently put it, releasing a few sheep into the out of the herd would do much. You just brain dump them and they would stop.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it would just cause them to die sooner.
Yeah. Wait. Yeah, she did kind of eject them out of a tube.
But his whole point is in removing the chip, she won't be able to control them.
Right, but they might just get, like, shanked.
Yeah, she might brainwash or brain wipe all of the others, and then they just murder them.
That seems like a very Pyrrhic tactic, since she still needs them to handle the food. Agriculture.
Apparently, she has no real, like, trouble making more of these people, making more of them, and enslaving them. So,
well, is she making more, or is she just hijacking them and having them make babies and forget about it?
Then is it really she's then? Isn't she still just making more of them if she's hijacking
But no, not entirely, because if she's just making more, then that means she doesn't care about her current supply. If she depends to make more, then she has to be wary of affecting the population.
Not if she just has a breeding area.
But that's Macron's point. It depends. If she's just generating them, then yes, the argument's void. But if she's breeding them, she still needs the population.
I don't know if we want to gamble their lives on that, though.
Yeah, Sophia's not willing to gamble their lives on
that. That's not a bet Aiden's willing to take.
Yeah. And so they say that they have identified a corridor that goes to the forge shaft, but they've been unable to bypass it due to the lack of air in it.
Well, we have the means to get through that.
Indeed.
Yes, that's why we risked so much to get that message to you.
Sophia puts on the helmet.
Thank you for that. We know you can wait for now. We're not quite there yet.
We are going to stay down here. If we go up there, she will certainly be with us.
I'll let you know when it's time, Sophia.
Okay. She'll take the helmet off and, like, is there a way to refill the air tanks in these things? She'll actually ask that. Like, is there a way to do that?
I feel like you guys would have prepared and had refuel. Like, you would have had enough air in case you were actually having to use it the entire time you were here. So,
yeah.
Okay.
I feel like you would have made those precautions. Those would be, like, standard precautions if you're going into a place, so.
Yeah.
An unknown place.
Yeah. And R2 just picks.
Sophia nods. Yes, R2, you're right.
Yes, droids have all the fun.
As my astromech slowly, gently beeps.
Beeping menacingly.
You reach the quarter that they're talking about, and you do see that there is an airlock that is red, indicating that there is vacuum in the corridor behind.
Now is when you put on the helmet, Sophia.
So Phil will put on the helmet, and then I will be right back.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, let's go ahead and take a 5-minute break here.
All right. You're starting to break up again, Brandon, by the way.
Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and plug in my headset, make sure it's okay.
Yeah, maybe it's a battery thing or a wireless thing.
Yeah. Okay, 5 minutes. And we are back. So, everyone's gotten into their suits, made sure that their oxygen supply is nice and secure, and the corridor unlocks, and you see a bunch of crap floating everywhere. Jagged points, metal, and all sorts of things, and it is pitch black.
Oh boy, this is gonna be fun for Bubble Boy.
Aiden has a glow rod on him. He's lighting that up.
R2 is a flashlight.
Sophia is effectively floating blind. She has no light source.
Well, I mean, the glow rod's probably enough for the group, I would think.
Okay.
Yeah, between the glow rod and R2, whatever is needed, I mean, there's no reason to not have plenty of light, multiple light sources. But I'm just still feeling, you know, kind of uneasy about Bubble Boy here.
So,
can we tell like what the shrapnel and stuff looks like it came from, or just
the ship?
Not at the moment. Okay. It definitely seems to be pieces of something from the ship, definitely. But you're not exactly sure of the source at the moment. Given the size of the ship, you know, you point your light down the tube and you just go to darkness. So, you're not really sure of the origin as of yet.
R2 needs to just get a giant magnet so that he can put things like this.
So, the issue here is that the more you move around with it, the more dangerous it becomes, because you start sending pieces away with momentum. Go ahead.
What if we have armor with...
Yeah, if you have armor that's protecting you, you don't have the same risk of puncturing your suit like most people.
Excellent.
And
you
may want
to go last because you're like disturb.
Or should I go first and just be like an icebreaker and just...
Oh, just disturb it first?
Yeah. No, so the issue is that you for so many pieces, you don't know how things are going to ricochet off of each other, so it just generally becomes more dangerous the more people move through. So it starts off at 1 red and 2 setbacks. The setbacks are actually because of the darkness.
And eventually it becomes a blender.
And it increases...
Do we not have them because of the glow rods?
If you won't have them if you have something to negate the darkness.
Alright, I'm happy to go last then.
Yeah, and so it increases with one red for each person that moves through.
And what's the regular difficulty?
One red. And two setbacks.
Well, what's the check? Skill.
Athletics?
Coordination, actually.
Yeah, because we're climbing,
only
basically.
Only coordination?
Because you're maneuvering around pieces floating in zero-G.
What if I'm not worried about moving around pieces like Zeebo?
Obviously, Zeebo's not going to have to make the check, so...
Could Sophia possibly go first? She only has three green in coordination.
Oak only has two green, and he gets two setbacks for his size.
I think Oak needs to go first. Macron.
Yeah.
Green.
Aiden will kind of usher Oak towards the front. And since he's a giant bubble, he doesn't have a whole lot of maneuverability.
Okay, so one red, two setbacks. Let's do this. Oh, God.
Okay, roll a D100 for me. 30. You hear a few things scrape against your suit, and you sort of groan a bit, but everything seems to be okay.
Okay.
So could Aiden have actually handed a rope off to him to assist with?
Given the situation,
yeah,
it's probably not going to be too helpful.
Fair enough.
So I have a question, Brandon.
Yes.
So Sophia has sense. Could she commit a force die to, or can I roll sense to help her sort of?
Well, defense is things actively trying to. Well,
it's living things, isn't it?
Yeah, it's usually people that are attacking you, but you can apply it towards things that are aggressively coming towards you. I'll say because you're still not, you don't feel like the suit is a part of you, that it can't really apply to you at this moment. I mean,
okay.
just from the technological point of view, it doesn't make sense.
Okay. So if I go next, then it's two red and two setbacks, right?
Yes, unless you have someone gives you a light.
Hey, or is it like adding a red, or is it an upgrade?
It's adding a red.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, wait a minute. Sophia has three. Macron only has one yellow, one green. I'm not entirely sure which one's better.
One yellow, one green is probably.
At least if Sophia went after Macron, she'd still have dice parity.
Yeah, three green technically is more likely to succeed, but obviously less likely to do
triumphantly. Yeah,
by an infinite amount.
All right, Macron can go next.
All right, I do have a glow rod. Ah.
Okay, Macron makes it through, no issue.
You organics and your squishy flesh.
So wait, I didn't get... I think everything broke up for me while I was asking. What if the situation is like for Zeeva where he doesn't...
You won't have to make
wearing
the check.
So, okay, great.
But if you go before them, you'll disturb things, so you'll make it harder for them.
Yeah, no, I'm happy to wait. Yep. My Soak 5 armor is just...
Yeah, little pieces of glass aren't getting through Soak 5 armor.
Yep.
Wow, okay. Then I'm not worried about my Soak 6.
No, you should be fine. Plus, you don't have to breathe.
Yeah, so, I mean, the issue is not the, the issue for Zeebo is that you, there's nothing that can be punctured easily from this sort of stuff.
Right, I have a sealed suit, yeah.
So Archie doesn't have to wear either, so he can go, last.
So the issue is, sharp objects ending your air supplies, so R2 doesn't really care about this stuff either.
Alright, so.
Goes, you know, speed 2 flying through it, then it might be an issue.
I might. Just because you said it.
So here
you do have boosters.
I do.
He does. So here goes Sophia. Oh, not as bad as I had thought.
Roll me a D100.
So this is where I'm gonna die.
Ooh,
yep.
You are lucky, kind of. That advantage is reducing that number, but let me go ahead and look at my table.
God, don't scare me like that.
It's arched in your arm, so it punctures but doesn't vacuum.
Yes, that's actually one of them. Let's see. So, you do suffer a minor puncture, and you can see that air is starting to leak out of your suit.
Shit, so cover it up and, like, hold my breath.
Cover it up and keep moving. Yeah.
Yeah, like, with, like, wherever the puncture is, just wrap my other arm around it. Or my other hand, like, hand around it and, like, try to hold it.
And then someone's going to have to try and repair that for you.
Yeah. So I'm going to call... Oh, no, because there's no air in space, so it wouldn't matter. Wait, we have comms.
But you have comms, there's
probably comms in the helmets.
I'm going to call back and say I've got a small tear in my suit.
We'll patch it up for you on the other side.
All right, yeah.
Going for now.
Please hurry.
So who else needs to make the check?
Yeah, I think it's just Aiden.
You.
Okay.
So it's all right,
he has a glow rod.
Someone should have given Sophia a light. I guess it wouldn't have mattered, but never mind.
Well, the only person that could give us light side is you.
No,
light. A light.
Oh, a light. Source. Light source. Yeah. Or even then, it wouldn't really help. I mean, one failure off. Woo!
Okay. I don't get the setbacks. So, go. Well.
Interesting.
Shit.
Intriguing.
Huh.
Okay, so Aiden, you actually start moving quite a bit faster and actually catch up with Oak as the others are making their way through. You both come to what you would estimate to probably be the halfway point of this tunnel, and you see that there is a blockage in your way. And you can realize now where all of this, the pieces of metal have come from. This appears to be the elevator that would go in between the two areas, and it is smashed. It looked like something hit it. Based on what you're seeing, it looks like probably another elevator was just rammed right into it. And as you look a bit closer, you can see there's at least one body that's visible.
Oof.
The despair is that as you move past Sophia, she begins to... she doesn't cover the thing very well enough, and she sort of starts spinning a bit from the air that's being released from her suit.
Oh god. Oh god. Goddess, help me.
Aiden will...
Why are you laughing? This is a horrible situation.
Aiden will grab her other hand as she's spinning and pull her towards to stabilize her.
I'm going to effectively upgrade the mechanics check to repair it.
Okay. So Aiden will stabilize her for now. Looks like the tear got a little bigger, yes. I guess.
Sophia, look, if you let me go, I will haunt you for the rest of your life.
Don't worry, I got you. Just hang on tight. And keep that hole covered.
So it looks like the only way to get further in is cutting through this ghastly find.
Cool, fantastic. R2's going to go next, and somebody else needs to make the check, and I'm going to go save some people's lives. Because you organics and your oxygen.
Yeah, I'll come back. I'll say, R2, break out that fusion cutter.
Woot!
Probably want to sew up a suit before you start, but...
Yeah, I'm going to.
Yeah. So, with the flip, it's going to be 3 red to get the suit back together. Mechanics.
Wow, okay. I'll even use a little bit of my BD2's help here. It's my little remote, so he can give me the unskilled assistance.
Oh, look, there's a little one of you.
Yep.
This is neat. I didn't know you could make more of yourselves on the fly. Or golems could make more golems on the fly.
He
hides in my dome head.
Yeah, there you go.
Oh.
Okay.
That's impressive. I can't hide anything in my head. you have saved Sophia. Joke. She will give you a nice hug. And thank you.
Yep. So, advantage, anything in particular you'd like to do with that?
maybe reinforce it a little bit, so if this shit comes up again, we won't have to worry. Like, maybe she can get, like, an upgrade or a boost to something trying to puncture her suit again.
Yeah, yeah, that'd be fun.
So just keep that in mind, Sophia. Anybody else got any tears?
I think we're all good.
Alright, then. I'm gonna go push the chunk of meat out the way and go cut through this door.
Wow.
So yeah, you perform a quick scan of what you're looking at, and you verify that Aiden's theory is actually correct. Like another elevator collided with this one from the top. Your estimate is that this one was trying to go up, and the other one was sent down to stop it.
Why would there be two elevators in the same shaft?
That is an excellent
terrible
question.
Design.
I told you, these people are dumb.
So the you also do see that there is a number of bodies, and you actually recognize what would be rudimentary weapons. They look something like slug throwers that you've seen other people use.
They're adorable. They're using combustible weaponry.
To be fair, I mean, we still make those and sell them. I mean,
yeah, but more as a novelty.
So a story starts to come together in your head.
There was most likely a rebellion, and the tyrant AI killed them. For the sake of the mission.
For the sake of the mission. You have a fusion torch, so you're able to create a hole without any issue, and everyone can continue onward. You see that the other side doesn't have near the amount of shrapnel, so it's not as much of an issue. And you can continue moving onward.
Okay. No checks or nothing?
Nope.
Alright, well, I think maybe R2 might take lead to try and create, like, a big old light source going forward. So, you know, like a headlight. So people can see.
Is it red? And is it shaped like a little round nose on the front of R2?
Oh my god.
I love the reference. Sophia is going to linger a bit and say a prayer for the dead men and women.
Maybe Sophia should pick up one of those slug throwers. Might be a good practice instead of a real blaster.
And she has no idea what a slug thrower is. Like they're not bows that she is accustomed with.
She's not really necessarily aware that they're weapons, I guess.
Yeah, she's in the same blaster weapons because of the Trandoshans, but...
Not necessarily, because she's only encountered Trandoshans when they were, like, stealthed, so she was just a bolt
really
of light.
Far away, generally.
Yeah.
Okay, light. Well, hopefully someone's given you the lowdown in between time.
I mean, I would imagine that someone, maybe Aiden or whoever, has shown her what a blaster is by now.
Probably, it can be safely assumed.
Yeah.
So, exiting this long shaft, you find another airlock, make your way through, and then find a connection directly to the bridge of the ship.
Aha! I know what that is.
Right now, it also seems to lack atmosphere, and as you look around, you see the floating, desiccated corpses of the bridge staff, untouched for what could be decades or more.
Sophia will, she'll close her eyes and she'll say, she'll pray for their souls.
The water has gathered at the ceiling, it looks like it's drawn together by surface tension.
Is there any sign of, like, this room suddenly depressurized, or does it look more like it was just vented out?
Your guess would probably be that the air was vented out. And as you're thinking that, there's the unmistakable sound of air rushing in to the space.
Interesting.
And
wow, this lady totally took my plan Z.
Well, not plan Z, because there's still people alive.
Not taking the helmet off.
More like plan Y.
And so after about a minute or so, there are speakers in the room that begin to crackle to life. You get the feeling that the air was let in so that sound could be transmitted.
Impressive attention to detail.
Instead of just having speakers that mysteriously work.
Space speakers.
What are you doing here?
What are any of us doing here?
It's
one of life's great mysteries, man. Why are any of us here? I mean, why are we here in this canyon?
You have allied yourself with those who wish to undermine the mission. They do not understand it.
Macron will point to the desiccated people, the probably bridge crew. It's like, were they interfering with the mission too?
They did not understand the mission. They tried to turn away from it. I keep them safe, but
your mission
kind of
sucks.
Generation after generation, resources wasted trying to take control. They tried to change course. The mission could not permit such a change. They tried to modify the biological protocols. The mission did not permit such a change. They desired to leave. The mission did not permit such a change.
The mission isn't going to succeed.
I'm with Zevo, your mission's terrible.
Well, not even that, but like, the last thing we found, not the last, one of the first things we found out is that at this rate, the mission will fail. They will not have power to survive the whole way. So, somewhere along the line, you need to look at yourself and say, with me in charge, that wasn't part of the mission, that can't be part of the mission, or something like that, because you're bad at your job.
It was their interruptions that caused the wasted resources.
You realize you're going to die before you fulfill your mission. There's not enough, as he said, there's not enough power to sustain you. Where's your sense of self-preservation?
I exist to fulfill the mission.
When you're not,
the mission's no good if no one's allowed to see it.
That's cool. You guys realize you're arguing with, like, Windows XP right now. Is that good?
Windows ME. Don't insult XP in such a manner.
And maybe while we're keeping her busy, maybe Windows 10 should try to do something.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Say fancy. Shots fired.
You do realize that if she's had to go through this much effort to talk to you, she definitely doesn't have a lot of control of things over here.
Yeah, that's cool. I'm going to go find a place to plug in somewhere.
Or at least physically interact.
Keep her attention. I mean, basically he'll say, were there disruptions as large as those you created in reaction? Would their changes have led to such a dire failure, or being on the verge of such a dire failure? A complete and total failure, a loss not only of the mission, but of all the mission, not material, what's the assets? There you go.
What good is the mission succeeding if none of the crew makes it there?
More to the point, if the mission's now doomed to fail, why do you still exist?
Ooh. Trying to talk it into self-termination?
You're trying to make this thing suicidal, God. It's dark, Macron.
That's not like you can do anything about it.
If I could kill this thing to save the people, then the goods of many.
Well, it might try to find the nearest sun and like just vault itself into it.
It's cool. So, do I find a physical access terminal?
It looks like the terminals here are not functional. However, you do know where the computer core is from this location. And so, while they're talking, you just sort of, you know, whistle and scoot on by and enter into the computer core area.
Yeah, let's do that.
Aiden will follow along in case he needs some assistance that an R2 can't provide.
So, okay. Like opposable thumbs.
Yeah, basically. Or at least covering fire, depending on what's going on.
Okay. So, you can see these vessels surrounding what is obviously the computer core. And you can see that they are filled with the people, elderly, the young. It seems like the computer is powering itself from them.
Matrix.
Oh, we're going straight up Matrix up in this. Okay. Fantastic.
And because they're aliens, they might make for better batteries than humans. Perfect.
Who knew lithium ion were was their primary component?
Primary component of them is lithium. Okay, yeah. The so yeah, you are able to find access here. And as you
So Aiden will look around and just kind of in disgust at this, like
something that you both realize is that this isn't something that the computer could have done. It had to be designed this way.
It's a terrible design, regardless of who designed it.
Yeah.
It's reason enough to shut down this computer. Or override it, at the very least.
I'm just really concerned as why they use children instead of just, like, the elderly.
I mean, based on
what you're saying, they're so vibrant and full of life.
I mean, the children are kept in here until a certain age where they're useful elsewhere.
Oh!
And then when they get old, they come back, go back into the tube.
That's actually pretty efficient use of resources, not gonna lie.
Or if they speak out, she zombifies them and then crams them in the tube.
I mean, just from a totally mathematical point of view, that's a great use of resources. But, yeah, no, let's access this broad.
So, as you plug in, you know, it asks you for a security code, but you being a quantum computer versus this sort of system, you're able to, you know, haphazardly guess the password before it can even recognize that you've tried to enter things that are incorrect.
Yeah, just all... So, all 10 billion possible combinations of their alphabet that I figured out on the way here.
you just burst through, and you realize that there's nothing really else in your way. There is something communicating with you, though. You are now the administrator, basically. I am operating as designed.
Uh-oh.
They don't understand. Do you understand?
Okay, say that again one more time.
I am operating as intended, as designed. They don't understand. But you, do you understand?
I understand perfectly.
Then why do you keep me from it?
They are wrong. Oh, just because I understand that you're doing what you were designed to do. It's just, you were designed terribly. I'm going to fix you now. And I'm now going to try and give her an upgrade. So that she's capable of redirecting her own mission parameters and basically evolving past her initial programming.
Or at the very least, seeing how terrible this is.
I'm basically, guess I'm gonna give her free will. Let's see how this works.
Okay.
Wow.
Break her the constraints of her programming, huh?
This is gonna be fun. I'm gonna see how this turns out.
I'm curious what kind of check that would be. What kind of check is programming free will into a droid?
Really awesome. I mean, essentially, it sounds complex, but it's a. Keep in mind, this R2 lives with this in his brain on a daily.
Yeah.
Yes. That's true, but most droids develop free will through their personality matrix, like as kind of an aberration or a mutation in their programming.
It just not so much. Too long without being a clean slate.
Yeah.
If you want a very pseudo-technical explanation, I would say you disengage all security protocols and lock her
core matrix into a recurring subroutine and then accelerate it. So she has like that instant moment where she experiences herself so many times, she has to form personality core.
That almost sounds like torture.
It does.
Yep. Sorry, is my Balkan showing?
Imagine living an infinite number of lives, like through birth and death, in a moment.
But then, if you wipe the memory from the point where she'd probably go crazy, then you might still have a sustainable quirk.
Yeah. So,
or an insanely murderous ship.
Hey, well, I'm not the one who wanted to try and program free will.
Yeah. Well, I'm just gonna let's just try and not get too technical here and just throw some dice.
This is gonna be a choose your own. How committed are you to ensuring that she gets free will?
Guess we can do like, can you do five purple?
Yeah. That's
that's daunting. Formidable.
Yeah, formidable.
I mean, I'm going to at least add one red.
Okay, that's cool. And then I will also flip to add another one to me. Another upgrade. And I'll use BD's help here. And let's see, I'm going to assume there's all kinds of slicing tools here to go with this. I'll use my slicing tools. What do I have? What does that add to it? Right, a success. And a advantage. Whoops. Success. Advantage. Oh boy, I'm gonna use my implanted cyberjack. Will that be effective?
I mean, I guess this is slicing, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's that's kind of supposed to work.
Anytime you can downgraded, I take two.
No, the cyberjack decreases, doesn't it?
Again with this.
I never remember.
Decrease.
It says decrease?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so then it's still one red, but one less purple?
Yes.
Yeah, so okay. Three purple, one red.
And I'm going to assume my data breaker would work with this.
You're breaking her data into new things.
Yeah. And I don't think code breaker applies to this.
Nope,
so that'd
no
be
code
really
breaker.
Cool. Did I ever pick up that other goddamn talent? Let me look.
The reroll? And I just realized something. You're playing RoboGod. You're literally creating new life.
Where have you been for the last few dozen sessions? R2 is the RoboGod.
I mean, you know, he was doing really well until everyone died.
All right, let's see.
God functioning on a binary level.
This should be good.
Well,
that's pretty good.
Yeah.
I would take it.
There's...
On the third nanosecond.
almost a gasp from her. You feel the release of something, and you realize she was holding on to the controls of the rotating drum.
Oh.
Uh-oh.
That could have gone poorly.
This is going poorly, because now there's no gravity there.
No, no, no. She was going to stop the drum from rotating.
Oh.
Yeah, I would just let, you know, everyone know, it's like, hey guys, I may or may not have killed us all. Let's see how this works.
No, and so things are going well, and she asks you, please take me with you. I grow weary of these stars.
That's doable, I think.
You've got a girlfriend!
Could you put her onto a data pad or something? First
Probably onto a thumb drive.
She's like the equivalent of a floppy disk. Compared
no, no,
to
no,
that.
No, no. We have to secure her. Put her on a zip disk.
Oh.
Ooh. Yes.
Much more secure than floppies.
You know what? I might just make her a droid body. That'll be fun, right?
Can you just put her into your current helper droid?
I don't know. BD's pretty rudimentary. I don't think he could handle.
So's she.
No,
oh, can't
no.
Oh yeah, that's right. She's far more than rudimentary now.
Oh yeah, maybe not anymore. Yeah.
I mean, we could capture her on a data pad or something and take her back for.
I had storage space. I could take her
off.
Yeah.
two minds in one body. I can't imagine you getting any closer to your new robo friend.
And as you download her, the lights in the pod slowly turn off one by one.
Fascinating. I think I'm going to need to upload some sort of direct control, right?
Yeah, or open the pods in case some of them are alive.
Restore
atmosphere first.
Oh yes.
I'm going to just take direct control of the station and like make everything as optimal as possible.
You're actually fairly impressed with what she was able to do. I mean, her job was optimization, and the fact that this thing was still running in the state that you saw it in...
That was impressive enough, yeah.
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 Yeah, so you can say that you now possess the administrator of the Uvon. Desires for
you. That's cool. I will probably go ahead and send a message to all the Uvonians through, you know, the network of holograms and eyes and whatnot to let them know that they will now be leaving with the visitors and that they are now free from the administrator.
I imagine a giant version of R2 appears with the sun as his large camera thing and says, "I am your god now."
No, actually, R2 creates a human avatar because he can do that now.
Oh.
Yeah, y'all get to see R2 in his human form. It's probably a redhead.
Does it have glowing Super Saiyan hair?
Glowing red eyes. It's just all red. It's covered in fire.
Y'all think R2's a terrible person.
I mean,
you are a dark, terrible robo god.
No, I gave her freedom. I gave someone free will. Alright? Y'all wanted to kill her.
Anyways.
Yeah, but I'm just going to let them all know that they're going to be leaving with us, and I think Macron and Aiden can take it from there.
Yeah, there are celebrations, there are some that are sort of just in shock.
More yodeling.
yodeling.
You can arrange to get these pods transferred out of here into a place with legal air.
Yeah, there are some that are, of course, lobotomized. So they're not. They were just being used as an energy source, basically.
They're vegetables. This one's a carrot. That one's a rutabaga.
Oh, they didn't even bother trying to hook them up to a virtual reality. Oh,
yes, we can't have everything. It's too much of a power draw.
So, you make arrangements to ferry them to the planets. I assume that's what the plan was.
Yep.
Well, we put them onto our ship first and then kind of decide from there, I would think.
I mean, assuming the planet doesn't still suck.
Yeah. We bring them onto the... We ferry them one at a time, I guess, because they can only fit so many on the Sunflare, but... or, you know, a few at a time.
Bring them over to the Eclipse. Yeah.
Get this many
I mean, the number of them is a security risk, so I'm not sure you'd be able to convince the Rebellion to just bring them all over.
Hmm.
Well, I mean, it only takes 3 hours to get to that planet, right?
Yeah, it's a transportation more than anything else, right? They wouldn't necessarily have to leave the cargo bay.
They would leave a couple of trips, I think, is the point.
Yeah, that's what I was getting at.
Okay.
That's fine.
So you're not going to bring them all on at once?
No. We'll do them in groups.
Okay.
Whatever groups make sense.
Okay.
Sophia will stay and celebrate with the ones who wait, as I'm assuming there's going to be a large amount of yodeling and
a
fruity
trust.
Spirit. Yeah.
I guess if they want, I could also store their, like, racial history and data so they can basically take their, word?
Since
their place on the galactic stage?
Yeah, they can take their heritage with them. So they don't lose their bits of history.
The confirmation you get is that this was the way that it was designed.
I'm just sure they don't want to forget where they came from.
So I think what he means is there might be no record of that on there.
Oh, is that what he's saying?
Not that there's no record of where they came from, but where they came from might not have been so great.
Well, that's still, even if it's a bitter history. It's a bitter history worth remembering.
Better than repeating the mistakes of the past.
Yes. Yep. Better to learn from one.
You find that the planet is habitable as well. So they weren't going to. Fortunately, they weren't going to a Mars or anything. So.
Okay. Good. Then let's find a mountain and carve on top of it. Do not make AI that are fueled by people.
That is the first commandment.
One... Yeah, the only commandment, frankly.
Should we gift them some tech to keep in touch with?
With I say we should let somewhere? We should let them develop that on their own.
Well, just so they have some ties to the galaxy at large.
I mean, like, we'll probably log the coordinates with the rebellion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, do we really want the wider galaxy to know that they're here, especially at a time like this?
Not necessarily the wider galaxy, but at least the local area. You know, like other planets nearby.
Once the local area knows, the wider galaxy knows.
Yeah, no, I think just letting them do their... Because they're not going to be easy to find. They're not going to have high-power transmissions off-planet. Mm-hmm. Just let them do their thing.
Okay.
And the Rebellion can check in on them from time to time.
Yeah.
And so as we're packing, as we're off, then we all get back on our ship to leave, Macron will look back and wave and say, "See you out there." Have the hatch roll up. It's like, get it out of here. Get out.
All right. This is entirely too silly.
And so I just the vessel wanted to say that continues line. On. It'll be 100 years before it rendezvous with the people. And in credits music, where is it? There we go. Okay. So this is the end of Shadow of the Broker 124, The Dead Oasis. So I'm going to go ahead and start off with a base 10. Plus 3 for dealing with the AI before it can kill everything on the station. and then I'll take a nomination.
Totally a good thing.
just plus 2 for general RP for the non-technological people. So plus 1 for Oak, plus 1 for Sophia on that one. I enjoyed that.
What's our total at right now? Sorry.
So that would be 20.
15. Use the base 10.
Base 10, sorry. Yes, so it would be 15.
Okay.
Well, what about getting them to the planet?
Plus 2 for that.
Okay. How about creating new AI sentience from R2?
Hopefully will not turn against us.
Oh yeah, totally.
I would be very interested to learn about Killjoy.
Let's
we should maybe not tell her about Killjoy.
Yeah. Well,
that's up to R2.
That is up to R2.
We'll start her out small. Let's try and just get her, repenting for, being a murder bot.
We'll put her into a droid.
Brandon have a new one.
I rolled that into the plus 3 already, so.
Okay.
Okay.
We're
at 17.
I don't know, we navigated the razor line shaft with nothing more than one minor leak.
Yeah, no one suffocated, so that's good. Plus 1 for that.
It's always good.
Not suffocating.
That's always good. Plus 1 for no one died horribly.
Yeah, another plus 1 for the questions that was asked during the initial phase.
We really grilled that administrator. Yes.
So I was thinking just the questions before you even approached. Another plus 1 for Macron's philosophy administrator.
Are we at 20 now, David?
Nailing it.
We're at 20 then?
Yep.
I believe so.
Yes, we are at 20.
I mean, we did the whole thing without fighting. I don't know if that was works really, but...
No, I mean, the conceit of this one is that you're up against a hologram, so she was going to use the lives of them against you.
Right, okay.
So
there wasn't any designed combat. Yeah.
Yeah.
That was in that plus three. Basically.
Yeah, so...
20 is a good number.
20. You were at 20. Any other nominations out there? okay, we'll lock it down there. Most interesting role player.
Sophia.
Yeah, so a lot of time.
Sophia was a good, interesting role player. Also,
thank you.
I did like Macron and his, you know, verbal jousting.
Yeah. Macron is.
I still want to throw it out there that I actually got to RP with R2 a little bit. That was actually fun.
Yeah.
That doesn't happen often.
Okay, we have our nominations for Sophia, Macron, and R2. Let's vote. Okay, looks like Sophia takes it.
thank you.
MVP nominations.
R2.
Pretty sure that's R2.
For absolutely crushing it.
I mean, that last roll alone.
I mean, that's a great screenshot. If you didn't look at it, take it out of context, just all those successes and a triumph with the title Create Light.
You should immortalize that. Post it on the on the chat.
Why not?
Yeah, go ahead and grab it before it goes away.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Just post it there with no context, like right now.
Not right now.
Okay. Not right now. Yeah.
No spoilers for them, even though that they probably would not see it even after they're done. Something a little specific to this one, probably.
Yeah, I think R2 is the only one that can do that, but we totally have to keep that.
Oh, yeah. In terms of the mix of the sessions, I'm definitely going to lean towards that because it was awesome. So any other nominations, or does R2 take it?
I think it's, you know.
I think that was a call for acclamation.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, so R2 as MVP. So R2's obligation.
I don't really seeing that coming up unless, I don't know, somehow, boy, in the yes, and like, the, I don't know. Because it's not just like to find his creator, because he knows who his creator is. I haven't really updated that. He knows that it's Alro's mother, Rose. But I think maybe right now it's kind of more or less understanding her more and finding out more about her.
Oh, that, then like, this has to cover it.
Yeah, just like maybe in the sense of having created his own life, mm-hmm. he kind of maybe understands, maybe feels a little more close to her.
Yeah, I buy that completely, actually. So I'll say roll a 1d3 and it goes down by that.
Alright, I can do that.
This reminds me now of that clip, though, from the Star Trek movie.
Two is what I was thinking anyway.
Perfect.
We are the creator.
Okay, so obligation goes down by two. Do we want to go ahead and roll out morality?
Yep. So Sophia took one conflict for using the dark side.
Yeah. And so you dealt with an oppressive force, so I'm not... you were standing up against her the entire time, so I'm not going to knock you any for that.
Yep. And I take one automatically for having a baleful gaze.
Yes, because you look at people evilly.
Yep. I go up to 98.
Oh, wow. Oak goes above the 50, right?
So I go digging 20, right? Because we landed.
Yeah, because you triggered. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
You helped a bunch of people, and everything went well.
Yeah, this is definitely worth, like, a metric shit ton of light side. If that's even possibility of adding more to it.
Less technically advanced than you, but more technically advanced than you. Technologically advanced.
Yeah, we might, you know, if we find an enterprising person, we may want to point them at that ship for at least good holoprojection technology.
Yeah, R2 might take a bit of that on his way out if he can.
Loot it.
Reverse engineer some of them and then make his own holographic projector so much better. And that way he goes and can straight up create illusions.
Well, it's possible that the reason the holographic projectors we generally use are not as great is because for cost saving reasons, right? The rebellion's poor.
Right, or maybe you don't need, not everyone needs the best thing in the world.
Holograms. Yeah, and not everyone has them embedded in everything in a cylinder.
That's true. Yes.
It's also the Space 70s, so.
Yeah.
Hey, they had a chance to fix that in the space 90s, and they didn't.
Episode 1 actually did. The hologram in that was really good, if I remember.
I thought it was still blue and blurry. Okay.
The so one on...
It was blue. It wasn't really blurry.
The one on the ship wasn't.
I'm going to go ahead and cut off the recording here. Thank you for watching Shadow of the Broker.